afternoon. Welcome to Beckwith Recreation Complex for another season of GG's Football on Streaming Sports Network Canada, SSNCanada.ca. I'm Nate Sager. I'm flying solo today to get our analyst from last season, you remember, for many years here on SSN, Wayne Jacobs. We always called him the coach. I guess that was prescient because he's now on the GG's coaching staff as the quarterback's coach. And obviously, the GG's, their home opener, everyone knows, sort of knows the situation for Ottawa. They come in at 0-2, and as they take on the defending national champion, the number one ranked team in Canadian Interuniversity Sport Football, the McMaster Marauders, and their coach, Coach Stefan Potasek, and of course, their top-ranked quarterback, Kyle Quinlan. The GG's, under Coach Gary Etcheverry, have their work cut out for them today, just to put it mildly. They are last in the 10-team Ontario University Athletics Football Conference in pass defense, 820 yards surrendered through the air through two games. Meanwhile, as they struggle to get comfortable in their newfangled, maybe it's old-timey double-wing offense, they've only thrown for 195, and those metrics seldom make for winning football. So the GGs are up against it. They can't afford to go to 0-3 and still rally to make the playoffs. The OUA seems to have a tight cluster of teams once you get sort of past the top three in the league, which is obviously the Marauders, today's opponent, and then you've got the Queen's Golden Gales and Western Mustangs, each at 2-0. They're meeting in their annual grudge match, the Beamer Bowl, down at Richardson Stadium in Kingston. That match on the score. You can put it on, put the TV on the score, put us on the computer, and get your fill of OUA football this afternoon. We're about 9 minutes to kickoff, and of course, I think the word for the GGs this year is different. And everything, as you can see, as you will soon see, we're out here at Beckwith Recreation Complex, where's Lansdowne Park, where the GGs have played for decades, now is closed for renovations for the next 2 years. GGs had to scramble to find a home field when they learned their new on-campus stadium wouldn't be ready till November. And the great people out here, Beckwith Township on the town council, they offered up this field. Beautiful facility. Definitely should take a look at it. Just sort of comes up out of you out of nowhere. You're, you know, driving along, you know, a two-lane road, and boom, there it is. Got facilities for every conceivable sport, but it's definitely like something you've never ever seen. You will probably never ever see something like this again. The number one team in CIS coming to a facility like this. It's pretty much packed. The bleachers all the way down one side of the field in front of us. They got the GG's Jockey Club filling the two sections in behind the benches, determined to make it as loud as possible for the Marauders. Ottawa, meantime, comes into this game really just sort of looking to hit something established. Everyone, as you know, opened the season with a whopping 63-18 loss to the Windsor Lancers in a rematch of last year's playoffs. Austin Kennedy looked like he was running through reps in practice with no defense as he threw for 482 yards. And then, of course, last week down in Toronto, they lost to the York Lions 47-36. That was York's first win over the GG since October 2003. That was York's first win over anyone not named the Toronto Varsity Blues or Waterloo Warriors since 2004, the days when Andre Dury was running wild for the Lions, you know, as the current Toronto Argonauts slot back. So big change, obviously big changes for the GGs. They've got new field, new head coach with Gary Etcheverry, a lot of new faces on the coaching staff, and the new offense with the double wing. They've shuffled some things around. On defense this week to try to get a little more pressure on the passer, try to get some better coverage. We're about 7 minutes till kickoff. Here, a bit of time to fill, but again, just unique atmosphere. And again, it's a one-time-only going to be a one-time-only thing, as the GGs will have their new field next season. And of course, they'll have the resumption of the crosstown rivalry on the gridiron with the Carlton Ravens set to rejoin OUA after what will end up being a 14-season absence. The Ravens, of course, folded in the late 90s. We'll soon have player introductions, but might as well run through the starting lineups right now. We'll have the starting lineups for you in a moment. And we'll step aside for the national anthem. vocals from the Jockey Club. That we have our national anthem. Quickly, we'll run through the starting lineups here before we get to kickoff. Obviously, Canadian football, fast-paced. It's pretty hard to run through 48 names and with only 20 seconds between plays. Quickly for the Master Marauders on offense, the supporting cast around Kyle Quinlan. Up front on the offensive line from left to right, it's Matt Sewell, 59 at left tackle, 65 Steven Schneider at guard, 51 Elliot Montag at center, 61 Jason Medeiros at guard, and 68 Christopher Pickard at the other tackle spot. The wide receivers, Max Cameron, number 14, on number 11, Ben O'Connor. And then they're a little more veteran with the slot backs, 83 Robert Babick. You'll remember him catching a Vanier Cup record 12 passes last season's national championship game. 82 Brad Focasato. He's also a veteran. Number 6, a new starter at slot back, Dallin Brooks. And then very first start, Kashawn Davis Reynolds, Mississauga native, gets the start at tailback with Jimmy Hill scratched with an injury. So Mac Dunder, actually the guy who began the year, number 3 on the depth chart table. And of course, the quarterback, number 12, Kyle Quinlan, over on the defensive side of the ball for the Gigi's. And as you might expect, the Gigi's have made some changes after getting shelled for 110 points and 1,122 yards through for the first 2 weeks of the schedule. One guy where you would expect him, number 49, Etide Latanzio, that nose tackle, 91, Matt McEachran at the other tackle spot. The ends are both new this week. Number 92, Rashid Timbilla, and number 95, Arnaldo Lavras, both Ottawa natives. At the second level, Rob Griffiths, number 55, at middle linebacker. He had the pick six last week against York. Fifth-year veteran Tyler Sawyer, number 52, and Francisco Rodriguez, another veteran at the outside backer spots in the secondary, and they will be tested a lot against Mac's multifaceted passing attack. It's Asun Bomcha, number 10, and 24, Chris Daly at the halfback spots. Number 26, Zach Rayner. Number 23, Randy Williams at the corners. They'll have to be sharper today. And, of course, the guy on patrolling center field, the hitman, number 6, Matthew Bon Lapointe. Now switching sides of the ball. On the Ottawa offense, of course, that offensive line anchored as the GGs come in here and waving the flag to a warm ovation from the crowd. Of course, Shavin Fernando, fourth-year veteran, the elder statesman, he anchors the offensive line at center. It's Fred Castleman and Taylor Service at the guards. Adam Valchek and Steven Ladanovich at the tackle spots. Entire offensive line returned intact. Of course, they had to learn an entirely new blocking scheme with the double wing, where instead, you know, there's not even any line splits. You put your foot down to the man next to you like he's your partner in a three-legged race. Then it's Simon Lamarcon and Eric Renault at the wide receiver spots, numbers 2 and 81. Vince Campbell, the exciting fleet-footed rookie at number 84 at slot back, along with 85 Maxime Moreau, the veteran. And, of course, Kevin McGee is the blocking back, lining up fullback, number 97, a former lineman moving into that spot, sort of a glorified guard. And, of course, the Sir Wilfrid Laurier connection at running back and quarterback with 25 Brendan Gillanders, who had almost 1,000 yards from scrimmage last season to lead the GGs, and of course the quarterback, 13, Aaron Colbin. And to stop them will be the MAC defense. Now the Marauders, I mean, they've only allowed 230 yards per game through 2 weeks, and these are early season statistics, so everything will even out over time. But they are concerned. They've had some slow starts, gave up first quarter touchdowns against both in their opener against the Guelph Griffins. They won that game 50-9, so ultimately it was moot, but they were still a little languid coming out of the locker room as far as Coach Stefan Potasek was concerned. And then, of course, they gave up an early one last week against Waterloo on a trick play pass thrown by a wide receiver. Ended up winning that game 68-21, but that's definitely something they don't think they can get away with. Starting for Mac on the up front of the defensive line, 94, Kareem Carrera, 99, Tanvir Bangu at the tackle. 78, Adam Dixon moves into the starting lineup at the other tackle spot. Then 52, you'll hear his name a lot, Ben DeGuillar, had a couple sacks last week here in the Vanier Cup. At linebacker, it's 42, Aram Ishu is the man in the middle. 13, Shane Beaton, and 7, Nick Shorthill at the outside backer spots. Then in the secondary, number 9, Alan Dixon, number 33, Stephen Dennis, are the veterans at halfback. The MAC secondary is probably one of the best in the nation, pretty much returned intact from last season. Out at the corners, it's 26, Steven Ventresca. You'll remember him making a critical interception that set up the winning field goal in overtime in the Vanier Cup. And 18, Joey Capito, who had an OUA record time, 4 picks in a playoff game last year against Queens. And number 8, Michael Daly, is patrolling the deep middle at safety. And, of course, we can't mention the Marauders without talking about their one connection to Ottawa. Number 4, Tyler Crepinia, sat out last week with a minor injury. But he is their kicker, native of Nepean, went to St. Paul's High School, played with the Myers Riders, basically set league records at every level of amateur football throughout his career in the National Capital Amateur Football Association. People, are, you know, the stories about him are, it's almost, he's got like a Bunyan-esque leg. There's no other way to put it. You know, if you're talking to warm-ups, people are telling stories about him trying a 50 when he was 15, playing for the Riders in the Ontario Varsity Football Junior League, which is 17 and under. Him trying a 52-yarder into the wind to try to win a game once against the Cumberland Panthers, and he kicked, and he fell short by about a foot and acted like he had lost the game single-handedly when there are probably professional kickers who wouldn't have been able to make that kick. So he is someone to watch, number four. Team's just down on the field for warm-up. And this is quite the atmosphere, as we say. As I mentioned earlier, we've got just cars piling in. We've got like long lines still to get into the stadium. Cars are, you know, the auxiliary parking is filled up. Definitely want to send some, definitely going to give some credit to our producer, Matt Copeland, who just did unbelievable, our indefatigable producer, Matt Copeland. He did great work in us there, our camera operator, Jill Sally. And before we kick off, we should definitely say a special thanks to Julie Tam and Jennifer Elliott at the University of Ottawa and Bill Malley at McMaster University for all their help this week, getting, you know, getting us ready, getting on the air. And again, like I say, you'll never probably not see a scene like this again. The number one team coming in the country, coming out to Beckwith Park, and the GGs just look to get some sort of momentum going toward the rest of the season. Again, the OUA, it looks like it's going to be a pretty clustered league once you get past the top three and maybe above the, you know, rebuilding Waterloo Warriors, who are just in their second season back from a suspension of the program, haven't won a game yet through ten tries since they came back. And actually, Waterloo has the distinction of sharing the longest losing streak in the country because the McGill Redmen got off the schneid finally last night in Montreal, beat the Mount Allison Mounties in an AUS RSAQ interlocking game, 38-9. So McGill ended their 23-game losing streak. First win from Redmond coach Clint Utley. And a little Ottawa connection to that, Sean Murphy, Ottawa native, believe played with the Junior Riders, or Sooners, correct me if I'm wrong, caught a touchdown pass in that game for the McGill Redmen. So McGill off the schneid, got a W, program trying to get back to where it was in the early part of the 2000s. Remember, they have the, it's a great answer to the trivia question, who was the last team other than Lavelle to win the Dunsmore Cup, the Quebec University football title, and indeed it was the Redmen back in 2002. Lavelle's going for their 10th in a row this year. And of course, Lavelle this week, Lavelle of course having a bit of an off season. They're all the way down to number three in the Football Reporters of Canada top 10. Just a, you know, way bad. I'm being sarcastic, obviously. All right, players getting their instructions at center field as they go for the coin toss. It's pretty windy out here today. It's going to be definitely affect things. We're watching Carpina in warm-up. He was hitting from 50. Matt Falvo and Justin Lavelle both dressed for Ottawa today. Falvo, of course, the fifth-year kicker, closing in on a number of school records this season. But Lavelle is dressed. One change in the OUA this year is teams now can...
McMaster will be receiving.
McMaster will get the kickoff, but just to finish what I was saying, now in the OUA they've switched to a 47-man dress roster, so a lot of teams or coaches feel a lot more comfortable now having two kicking specialists on the roster as opposed to just one, was what we saw in the past. Of course, I might be dating myself. I can remember when, you know, teams weren't even sure about dressing someone just to exclusively kick. You know, the backup quarterback was the punter, and one of the defensive backs might have kicked off. Mac is going to take the kickoff, as we mentioned. Sean Davis, the running back, is maybe one of the men back deep. That's John Negaleka And number 34, Wayne Moore, the rookies are the deep men for the GGs as Felvel gets set to put the ball down on the 45, kicking off from the right hash. GGs moving right to left on our screen in the first quarter. Mack will have the wind. And we're going to be underway in a matter of seconds after a whole long offseason of anticipation. A season of GG's football, unlike one you have probably ever seen before, and you can take that any way you wish. Fowl taking his time. Again, we mentioned it is breezy out here. Of course, we're filling it up here in our crow's nest press box, Jill, Matt, and I. And we're underway as Fowl kicks off. It's a bit of a short kickoff. Moore bobbles it. Taken by Negaleka. Good coverage by the GGs, and they down him inside the 20, and that's exactly what Ottawa was hoping for, as Mack has a little trouble receiving the kickoff, and the Marauders will be pinned as the ball is going to be spotted at around, looks like, the 22-yard line. And I think that's what you want. Make Mack go the field every time, if you can. Of course, at some point I'll usually go into my little digression about how I think at some point the CIS does need to adopt a CFL kickoff spot of the 35-yard line as opposed to the 45. But obviously the GGs will take that every time. Quinlan opens with three to the field. Hand off to Kashawn Davis Reynolds, and he's brought down after a moderate gain of about 5 yards. Yeah, they'll mark him with 6 yards. Davis Reynolds had 95 yards last week in mop-up duty against Waterloo, but with Hill ailing, moves him to start. It's actually Kashawn Davis Reynolds. Apologies for that. Quinlan again. Quinlan looking short side. Has a man behind coverage, and it's caught by Babich for a first down on the corner route. All the way out to the Marauders' 51-yard line. Gain of 25 on the play, and those are the kind of passes the GGs cannot give up. Mack is in the hurry up here early. They actually mark it at the 52, so officially 26 yards on the play. Quinlan, he's got Brooks as the number three receiver to the field. Quinlan looking, takes what he did, and now he's got to bring it down. Quinlan flushed down to the left. Quinlan faking, and he'll just run back, and the GGs stop him. Looks like Griffiths wrapped him up, and it's a quick whistle. So officially, I think it's going to be a no gain on the play. Or maybe it looks like he might have picked up one, but again, good contain by the GGs. And something the GG defenders talked about this week is officially it's a 2-yard gain for Quinlan. A little tough to see from my vantage point. Something the GG defenders talked about this week, they thought Guelph and Waterloo were just giving way too big a cushion to Mack's receivers, and Quinlan was just, you know, it was like he was like a kid in a candy store, just taking whatever he was given. Second and 8 for the Marauders, their first long yardage situation of the afternoon. Quinlan, pressure up the middle, he's sacked, and the ball is loose, and the GGs may have it. Big dog pile in the end, and yeah, Ottawa signaling they have it up. And that is the first sack of the year on Kyle Quinlan. He was just a hard hit from the blind side, and Ottawa will take over. And that is something that Ottawa did not do nearly enough in their first two games. They'll have the ball on the 41-yard line. It was Griffiths on the hit. Sack and a fumble. And that ends sort of an unblemished streak for Quinlan. It wasn't sacked or intercepted in the first two games. And the GGs quickly to the line of scrimmage. No huddle for them at all. And there's the handoff to Kevin McGee on first down. And he'll just move the pile for ahead for maybe 2 to 3 yards. Almost like looking, you know, shades of Refrigerator Perry back in the days of the Chicago Bears. Officially, it's a gain of 2. Mack quickly runs defenders in and out as they get ready for this 2nd and 8 play. Goldman quickly to the line. Won't be a lot of time for commentary between plays with both teams in the no huddle. Goldman looking to pass. Has a man open, and Campbell drops it. Would have been a first down catch. Now the GGs have a bit of a decision time for the GGs here early, with just 2:58 gone in this game. Third and eight on the 39. You really don't want to punt from here. But again, the wind is really difficult today. And indeed, Felvo is coming on to punt indeed, just a little too long to try the field goal. John Negaleka drops back deep for the Marauders. Along with Adrian Masati. Falvo aims for the coffin corner. Gets it down, takes a bit of a bounce. Negaleka taking it inside is at the 5. Breaks the first wave of tacklers, but Trevor Seal is there to wrap him up around the 16-yard line. And again, the GGs will force the Marauders to start from inside their own 25. So Ottawa unable to take advantage of that takeaway by their defense. And you're not going to get many opportunities like that against the McMaster Marauders. Mack was offside on the punt. And so now Ottawa can decide whether to, you know, go put the offense back out or put this kicking unit back out, because it could be third and 3 from the 34. And indeed, they will take the option here. Looks like got Latanzio. I can see Latanzio back in. So indeed, they're going to actually try the field goal, 41 yards into the wind. Matt Falvo, of course, does all the kicking duties for the GGs. Colbin to hold. And I was joking about with someone before the broadcast. We've had the Green Bay Packers in the NFL on Thursday night, and then the Calgary Stampeders last night. Each ran the same fake field goal play for touchdowns. You're almost going to be disappointed if someone doesn't try it today in CIS. But it's a straight kick away by Falvo. It's wide to the right. Mack's going to get the chance to bring it out. Allen Dix, and Dix cuts to the right, gets inside a block from Colbin. Looked like a push in the back there, but eventually he's brought down around the 31-yard line. Andrew Randall makes the stop. It's the Marauders indeed. And maybe that's just the way it's gone, indicative of the way it's gone here early in the season for the GGs. They get a second chance at either points or pinning Mack deep, and Mack actually ends up gaining 15 yards on the replay down, or 14 officially. They marked it down at the 30. So 11, exactly 4 minutes gone here in the first quarter. No score yet. Quinlan again now quads to the field. Has Cameron as the lone receiver. Hand off to Keshawn Davis Reynolds, and he breaks it outside, and he'll have a first down at the center stripe. Big gain as Battle Point finally came over to run him out after a gain of 25. So that is the second 20-yard-plus play already for the Marauders. And they'll come right back to the line of scrimmage quickly. And again, this really becomes a game of speed chess with both teams using the hurry up. Got Babbitt slotted right, handoff to Davis Reynolds over left guard, and he's off and running again. Another first down, all the way down to the GG 41-yard line. Cassine Davis Reynolds now all the way up to, by my count, I believe about 46 yards on his first 3 carries. And again, this is the guy who started out obviously number 3 on the depth chart, but Chris Pezzetta blew on his knee in training camp, was lost for the season, and then Hill gaining the day off. Flag down, and that'll wipe out the play. It looks like it might have been a procedure penalty against the Marauders. Babbage had a pretty nice catch on the end of that, on the seam route, but again, I think this will be coming back. Once again, thank you for joining us on GG's Football, for GG's Football on Streaming Sports Network Canada, sscanada.ca. No scores thus far, 4:48 into the first quarter. Actually, yeah, offside against McMaster. We might have had offset. So we got the offside signal against Mack, but it's actually being moved up 5 yards.
This is where, foul on the
GGs. Yeah, indeed, the GGs get the personal foul, and that is, again, something they got to clean up in their game, is the penalties. They're not doing themselves any favor, so it's first and 10 over again, except 10 yards up for the Marauders, who, of course, needed just 2 plays to get out from their only 30 yards. And Quinlan going for the end zone, Focasado behind coverage, caught for the touchdown! Brad Focasado gets open 30 yards on the play. There is a flag down, but the touchdown will stand, and the indication is it's against Ottawa, so that may be applied on the kickoff. And again, the start the GGs cannot afford. Mac goes, they might unofficially, three plays, 80 yards for the touchdown. Some of the crowd still filing in. It's already, we'll find it's already 7-0 for the Marauders as Tyler Carpina comes, if Tyler Carpina indeed adds the convert. And that was just a little bit too easy. No help over the top from Ottawa. Focusado, who went to the CFL E-Camp, the evaluation camp, didn't have too hard a time there. Carpina indeed does put it through. So with 4:59 gone, it's 7-0 for the Marauders. And the GGs will need a response. Had a golden opportunity there after Rob Griffiths had a strip sack on Quinlan that set up the offense at the 41-yard line, but they were unable to move. Campbell had a tough drop there on the crossing route. Although it was good to see that the GGs, you know, going to the air early. Obviously, they came into this game last in the OUA with just 195 yards through the air in two games. And I was joking, Ed, that's 97.5 average. That's not how many passing yards you want. That's a FM radio station. And again, the roughing the passer penalty on the GGs that I alluded to on the touchdown play will move the kickoff off to the 50. And this is probably where Carpina, he averages 58.8 per kickoff. This is probably one where he would love to show off that leg and just drive it through the blue paint in the end zone here at Beckwith Park. Again, we mentioned beautiful facility. I just feel so bad the Windsor Lancers don't come here because, you know, it's got their colors in the end zone. And of course, Windsor came to Ottawa twice last season. Carpina kicking off and, again, drives it deep into the end zone and over the head of Soombom Cha, who is going to bring it out. Cha cutting right to left, looks for a hole, and is brought down. Maybe he should have stayed in the end zone. He only gets out to the 2-yard line. Indeed, you don't get the out to the 20 rule. They'll mark him at the 3. Of course, the second series for the GGs, they went 2-0 on the first play, on their first sequence of downs. And Max, of course, I mean, this is a tough offense to prepare for. Nobody else runs the double wing in OUA football. It is, you know, it's cliche to say quarterback league, passing league, but it certainly is. Colvin rolling out on first down. He has to get rid of it, or it might be a safety. It looks like he got back into the end zone, but indeed he's brought down. Looks like Ben DeGuillar will get credit for the sack. And again, pass protections have been an issue for the GGs early in the season. I mean, the thing is when you pack in the offensive line that tightly, you know, you really leave yourself maybe vulnerable to some pressure off the edge. So Colvin, a 2-yard sack for DeGuillar. It'll be 2nd and 13 officially back at the 1-yard line. And the GGs just, you know, trying to stay out of a disaster here early on. I mean, just avoid a loss of yards and maybe take the safety and try to regroup, get the field switch. Lamar Conn was the only man out wide. And again, it's Colvin rolling out. Gives the quick handoff inside, but that stopped up. The first carry of the day for Gillanders, and it only goes for 2. So Ottawa in a situation where they'll likely have to concede the 2 points and go down 9-0. I can't really see them kicking into the wind. And, of course, that kickoff rule, the CIS rule is still a little bit more advantageous to conceding the safety than the CFL, which has sort of made some measures to try to discourage that, you know, force teams to kick it out and play some defense. Of course, last week, conceding the safety doesn't always work out. I mean, last week, the Bishop's Gators gave up 4 in the first half against the Laval Rouge Or and lost the game by 6. So, I mean, if they'd conceivably, that might have been a different. Of course, there's no guarantee they would have stopped Laval from scoring if they'd given them the shorter field. So Felvo stands back in his own end zone. Mac with 2 men deep. Indeed, Felvo will kneel and take the safety. So Mac goes up 9-0 here with 6:28 gone in the first quarter.
Ottawa kneels in the end zone for a safety.
And again, the questionable decision by Cha to bring the kickoff out of the end zone. But again, you know, you're eager, you want to make a play, it's the home opener. I mean, if you just sort of needed to get that one tackler. The Marauders will scrimmage from the 35. I mean, this action's fast-moving action here early in the game with both teams, you know, using a sort of hurry-up offense, calling the plays at the line of scrimmage. Hopefully we'll have some out-of-town scores from across the OUA as the afternoon rolls on. Of course, that big one down in Kingston, Western versus Queens. two both nationally ranked teams. There's a shovel pass. And Babich will take it inside and cut it up and get close to the first down. Little bit of deception there. It looked like Chris Daly came up to trip him up. And there was a flag on the play. Could be probably a blocking infraction on the Marauders. Just judging by the body language of the McMaster players, indeed it is. We're already walking back like the ball's going to be respotted. Yeah, holding on the Marauders, so it'll be first down and 20. We really, I mean, the offense that Stefan Potasek has at Mac is just a sort of a treat to watch. Really, you know, Mac sort of, you know, they were sort of always a mid-table team in the OUA until Greg Marshall came in the 90s and rebuilt them, you know, sort of in his mold, which was, you know, a power running team, which could, you know, had receivers that could go deep. You got an injured man down for the GGs. Rob Griffiths is getting helped off. Actually, Chris Daly jogging to the sideline too. They're both shaken up. Both veterans now for Ottawa. So shuffle the deck a little for the GGs. Trevor Seals actually wasn't listed in the starting line of the depth chart. He's in there now in that front seven for the GGs. Corey McDermott, of course, uses a lot of different fronts. You see Ugo Levesque now check in. So first and 20 for Marauders. They give it to Cassine Davis Reynolds, and he almost might have it on his own here as he stays still on his feet and out to the 41-yard line. 16 on the play for Cassine Davis Reynolds as he's now up to 62 yards unofficially. Actually, they'll give him, looks like they're giving him about 13 on the play. The second and 5. Excuse me, 15. Early season arithmetic for me. Quinlan on second and 5. Davis Reynolds set to his right. And Quinlan's going to be a quick throw and a first down catch by Babick, their possession receiver, out to the 45. It will be enough for the first down. Quinlan will take that all day if it's given to him. It's a tough route to defend. You know, basically sort of have to hope you can get a pass rusher, maybe just to get his hands into the passing lane, obstruct the quarterback's vision a little bit, and force the incompletion. The delay here is the ball spotted, but it was obviously a first down out to the 46. Second catch of the day for Babick. Brad Focasado, of course, had the 30-yard touchdown early, and Cassine Davis Reynolds has just been running wild here. Unofficially, we've got him at above 60 yards on about four carries in the first quarter. GGs have only had the ball twice, both times two and out. Missing a field goal on the first possession and then conceding a safety on the second. Quads to the field for Quinlan on first and 10. The Ack actually keeps a tight end in on the left side. Fake handoff, a little bit of pressure on Quinlan. Now he's got to pull down, flush down to the left with McEachern in pursuit. Gets past Pierre-Yves Laverne and will have the first down before Tyler Sawyer runs it out of bounds. But for the third time in three possessions, the Marauders are across center field into GG territory thanks to the 15-yard scramble by their quarterback, Kyle Quinlan. And he does that a lot. Everyone sort of remembers the moment in the Vanier Cup last year where he basically hurdled a Lavelle defender on one of those scrambles out to the left. Officially, it's 14. I'm watching the spot by the side official on our side of the field, and sometimes it takes a while for them to get their marking the same way. So again, four to the field for Quinlan on first down as they keep that tight end spot. Davis Reynolds, and this time the GGs have him. A flag is down as he's wrestled down after a gain of 5. And even when the GGs get some decent penetration, Davis Reynolds able to just sort of drop the shoulder and bowl ahead for good yardage. I'm assuming with where that flag was thrown, it's going to be on Mac. And again, they're walking it back. So two holding penalties on this drive for McMaster. You know, Stefan Potasek, he's not, you know, everyone remembers his mantra from last season with the Marauders, leave no doubt. He's not going to be happy with those two early holding penalties. It'll be first and 20 for Mac back at their own 50 after this. get a little Brian Adams summer of 69 here. Maybe that makes people feel a little bit warmer, just the mention of summer. It's breezy today. It's football weather. Quinlan now first and 20. Back in the five receiver set. Fakes the handoff to Davis Reynolds. He's got time. He's going deep. Focasado is behind coverage again, and he's got it for the touchdown. Two catches, two touchdowns for Brad Focasado as he got behind his man. Great beat, Francois Rodriguez on the play. Straight seam pattern down the field, 60-yard touchdown. And with that, the Marauders out to a 15-0 advantage. And I'm not saying we saw this coming, but yeah, some people did see it coming. That will go work out to a 75-yard drive by Mack. And they actually had 20 yards in penalties on it, so they actually went 95 on that one. Rapinoe will put another one over the fence. I think by the end of the day, he's going to actually try to put one over the outfield fence on the adjacent baseball diamond. He should put some money down on that with his teammates. He's got the leg to do it, and he might not get a chance to kick a 50-yarder today. So we're 8:34 into the first quarter. Two touchdowns for the Marauders. Gigi's still looking for their initial first down of the afternoon. Maxime Moreau and Sumbam Cha are back deep to receive the kickoff from Crepina. Gigi just needs something good to happen, really. I mean, talking to the players this week, they kept saying on defense, you know, 11 of 12 guys are doing the right thing, and then it's just one guy, you know, it's never necessarily the same player, but it's just one thing isn't there. But Quinlan definitely had more than ample time on both of those touchdown passes to Focasado. Crepina, end-over-end kickoff. This time it will drive Cha back into his own end zone, but only a couple yards deep. He'll bring it out, look for a seam, but the Marauders have him stuffed up inside the 20. And once again, the GDs will start in poor field position. Dylan Roche Crane in on that tackle. Veteran man out of Port Colborne Lakeshore Catholic High School. Well-known football powerhouse down there in southern Ontario. So the GDs mark it at the 14, so the GDs actually, remember, had some Mac in some pretty disadvantageous field position on their first couple drives, made them starting from inside their own 25, but now Mac just, you know, that's the mark of a defending national championship champion. They've switched the field. Colvin on first down as the GDs come out in that double wing. And the handoff goes to Gillanders, and Gillanders has a hole, first down, close to a first down, gains about 7. For Nick Short, he'll helps bring him down.
Falls in number 25, Brendan Galanis in the play, six yards for the game.
I'm going to say they announce it at 6, but it looks like more like a 7-yarder. And again, so that's what the GGs want. You want to get defenders running in different directions because they're watching. You know, not sure who has the ball. I mean, there's some plays in this double wing where the man that Colvin hands the ball to first isn't even going to be the ball carrier. There might be another handoff involved. Gigi's will look to move the sticks for the first time this afternoon as Colvin moves under center. Another quick handoff, and this time it's Gillanders again, and he's got the first down outside the hit to the 31 before he's wrestled down by Shane Beaton. And that's what they're going to do, make Mac run sideline to sideline. Mac trying to quickly sort of situation substitute, run some different defenders in and out just to keep their force unit players fresh. You see Trevor Gary, you know, number 3, running in. See the defensive lineman running in and out because, I mean, going without a break between plays, really tough on those big interior linemen. So back-to-back rushes by Gillanders, the GGs definitely need to get more out of. Now it's Nagundi again carrying on the sweep, and Frank's got room to the outside. Nagundi first down and more, and he's down the sideline into Marauder territory. Marked out at the 51. That goes for 28 yards on his first carry of the afternoon. And And the GGs definitely need to get Nagundi and Gillanders, their two tailbacks. I guess they're wingbacks officially in this offense. They give them the 52, so it's 27 yards for Nagundi on the play. Last week, Colbin had 132 yards on the rushing. But really, I mean, with a misdirection offense, you want your best ball carriers getting more of the ball. And Nagundi and Gillanders combined only had 100 yards. So when the quarterback rushes the two wingbacks, I don't think that's exactly what you're looking for. See if the GGs stay on the ground here. Here's the inside handoff, but the Marauders quickly on it. And Gillanders is tripped up by Aram Ishu, the middle linebacker. Just three yards on that play. You'll see a lot of different things from this GG offense. Now second and seven. Ottawa four straight plays on the ground here on this drive as they've moved across center field for the first time. Started once in MAC territory, but weren't able to get the first down. A tricky motion there before the snap, but as a handoff to left side to Gillanders, he's going to have to do some fancy stepping to make this first down as Mack was all over it, and he's wrestled to the ground by Michael Kashak, the rookie defensive lineman. Ottawa might have gone to the well once too often there. It takes a long time to sort of develop those power runs to the outside. The Marauders chased it down from the backside to hasten a punting situation. So it'll actually... be the first punt of the season, first punt of the day, excuse me, for Colbin. GGs have a man onside. Simone Laracon's is onside just to give the Marauders something else to think about. Now they bring him up. Falvo's going to try to angle this one outside the hash marks. Taken by Mack, a flag down, might be no yards, and if it is, that's 15 on the GGs. Someone lost a helmet. Returned out to the 35, so the GGs only net 15 on the punt, pending the resolution of the flag. Check. Marauders out to a 16-0 advantage here in the first quarter, 3:06 remaining in the period. Yeah, indeed, no yards against Ottawa. Let's see where they mark this. It's actually going to be move the ball out slightly, so they gain about 3 yards on the penalty ahead of what they had already picked up on the return by Andrin Masadi, native of Stony Creek, Ontario. So Quinlan already with two touchdowns in the first quarter, so 7-0 TD to interception ratio. Kashin Davis Reynolds with the handoff, bounces off a tackle. Actually, it's Quinlan keeping it, faked out everyone, and has a gain out to the 52-yard line. Totally fooled the GG defense and fooled me. So Quinlan now, he's probably above 10 yards a carry. He's only run the ball, I believe, three times so far. The GG defense, in the first two games, it was giving up yards by the boatload through the air. Now they're having trouble stopping them on the ground, too, as well. Quinlan quickly back to the line of scrimmage on first and 10 from the 51. Flag down. We got a whistle now to stop play. That usually means offside against the offense. One of the slot backs mistimed his run up to the line of scrimmage. Or as Hamilton Ticats fans might put it, he fantoosed it. Andy Fantuz, of course, always, the great receiver for the Ticats and previously the Saskatchewan Roughriders. And, of course, a Heck Crichton winner with the Western Mustangs, but always a guy who always managed to stay on the side of onside. And sometimes, you get called for it, but all the great ones do. Again, it is an offside against the Marauders. So first and 15, back at their own 54 on the left hash. Sheen Davis Reynolds off to a big start on the ground for the Marauders in his first start. Marauders with a bit of a cluster formation. Quinlan looking right, airing it out for Focasado, and he's got it for the first down to the GG 38. Gains 18, and Focasado, I think that puts him above 100 yards already because he went 30 on the first touchdown, 60 on the second, and a nice well-run corner route. Moves the ball back into GG territory. So Quinlan getting it done with his legs and with his arms. Quinlan looking right, just taking what the defense gives him. Complete to Ben O'Connor. Spins off one tackle and is wrestled down. Looks like it'll be a first down for Ben O'Connor. Graduate of Frontenac Secondary in Kingston. So sort of like a home game for him. I know people from Queens were wishing they were coming here for a game this year. Get the Gales and actually host the GGs on 2 weeks from now on September 29th. They're joking like, hey, you know, this would be almost close to home for us. So it's first and 10 at the GG 26 after the 12-yard pass. Quinlan again trips to the field, bringing a man in motion in for extra protection. Quinlan has to step up in the pocket. Quinlan scrambling with a man in hot pursuit, and he'll be brought down around the 21-yard line. Gigi's not opening up that middle where he sometimes likes to just scramble for first downs on those sort of improvised QB draws, but it's actually an 8-yard gain. So second and 2 coming up for the Marauders. Kyle Quinlan, of course, as you know, was in camp with the Montreal Alouettes this year, hoping to get some sort of shot. And there's that shovel pass again, and Babich will have the first down. Cuts inside, but Chris Daly leads the pursuit for the GGs, and then Pierre-Yves Laverne there to finish it off, but it is a first down for Mac on the, the speed shovel to Babich. Really, basically just a long handoff. Goes down as receiving yards, but it's essentially a running play. And the Marauders are in the red zone again. First and 10 at the 18 now on the right hash. Quinlan, I don't think he's taking a snap from under center. There he is, guns it, but he overshoots Ben O'Connor. But a flag is down in the end zone on Randy Williams. Looked like the pass had sailed by O'Connor, but if this flag's on the GGs, it might put the ball on the 1-yard line. And would almost give Mac an automatic touchdown if they can convert. And then with a quarterback like Quinlan, they ought to be able to. It is pass interference. See if that's marked on the 3 or on the 1. It is marked. Pass interference in the end zone is an automatic ball on the 1-yard line situation. It's only a 15-yard penalty anywhere else on the field. So, again, Mac poised now to take the lead out as we are down to fewer than 30 seconds in the first quarter. And it's been all McMaster thus far. And Quinlan now, he actually does take a snap from under center, and he'll burrow in for the touchdown. Shades of the great Phil Cote, who used to do that for the GGs back about a little more than a decade ago. But he puts it in, and he puts Mac up 22-0 here in the first quarter. So Mac's had drives of, 75, 80, and now 72 yards in the first quarter as they've just walked on up and down the field against the GGs, who had some bad luck a couple of times. Of course, Campbell had that drop on the first possession, and then Mac came up with a big second down stop after Ottawa was able to move the ball at the double wing. Crepina boots it through. He still hasn't got one onto the ball diamond. Someone sent a note down to him to try to do that. It's definitely achievable. Excuse the levity, folks. It's shaping up to be a bit of a long afternoon. 23-0 for the Marauders. GGs just need to string together a couple of positive plays as Moreau and Sumbong Cha go back for the kickoff. Of course, Crepina buried the GGs offense with his last two kickoffs, made them start on the 3, then they had to concede the safety, they had to start on the 14, and there was GG's able to move, but that's a lot of field to cover, especially for an offense that really needs to sustain drives because you're going to run-based team. Unless you can have someone break an 80-yarder, you're going to definitely have to be looking to put together 10 to 12 play drives. So Crepina to kick off, puts the ball in the right hash, and it's a short kickoff this time just to give the GG something else to think about. Taken at the 25, and the Marauders quickly on it, so the GGs will get the ball in the 30. That's actually going to be their best starting field position in a while. But again, Mac just trying a few different things to just try to keep the GG's return team honest. Ball marked right at the 30. We'll see what if Ottawa will open it up in the passing game here. Colden's gone, looked to go to the air a couple of times, but hasn't completed a pass yet. But if you watched them in practice this week, they were definitely looking. I mean, it is an unconventional offense, but you can throw out of it. thread. Yeah, definitely put just as many receivers into a pattern as any spread tack. And there's the Whirly Bird. The handoff goes ahead to Lamar Kahn. I believe it was to Lamar Kahn. Sometimes tough to tell with all those bodies clustered up, but the Marauders are quickly on it for a gain of three. Actually, it was Gillanders. That is the end of the first quarter. Kyle Quinlan, two touchdowns by air, one by land, helping stake the Marauders to a 23-0 advantage over Ottawa. GGs have a raucous home faithful behind them, just waiting for something to cheer for. It'll be second and eight at the 32 coming up when we resume play. I want to thank you for joining us here for GGs Football on Streaming Sports Network Canada, SSNCanada.ca. I'm Nate Sager. Got our producer, Matt Copeland, and our camera operator, Jill Sally, working with doing great work for us to bring this game to you this afternoon from the beautiful Beckwith Recreation Complex in bucolic Beckwith Township. Wait a minute. Beckwith Place.
If you want to, I can talk about it for a little while.
Okay. We'll be back here in a second with the GGs set the scrimmage from their own 32-yard line. We'll have Jen Elliott from the University of Ottawa by to talk about this facility here at halftime. It is obviously definitely a unique place, a unique setting for Canadian University football. There's Colbin faking the handoff to Gillanders. Colbin keeping it. Now it's a pass, and it's got a completion to Moreau, and he's lit up by Mike Daly, but he has the first down. On the play action, first catch of the afternoon from Earl, first completion for the GGs, and indeed they're on the move and rolling, and that's how the double wing is supposed to work. Mack did a good job of closing, but by then Moreau had already done the damage. First down out to the 44-yard line. Pickup of 12 for Maxime, fifth-year receiver. All four of the GGs starting receivers are from the province of Quebec, the football hotbed of Quebec. There's the quick pitch to Gillanders inside. Looks like the Marauders were onto him quickly. And then Brendan picks up about 2 yards on the play. Second and eight coming up. GGs picked the last one up through the air. Mac really packing in their defense close to the line of scrimmage. I don't think Joe. Colbin has Marvel with a little bit of a rip motion. Colbin rolling out. Play action again. Completion to Gillanders. A flag flies. It could be roughing the passer against the Marauders. Colbin was about a half yard shy of the first down, but that likely will be academic if indeed it's a roughing the passer call. Flag was thrown by the referee after Colbin had released the ball. And yep, roughing the passer. It's going to move the ball all the way down to about the mat. Into Mac territory, inside the 40, probably, to about the 40, excuse me. Yep, first, it'll be first down for the GGs on the 42. So Gillanders came up with about a 9-yard gain on the pass play. I mean, that's really what you need to do with a quarterback like Aaron Coleman. He's not a touch passer because, maybe he's the second year starting. Maybe hasn't it, with this offense, you're not getting a chance to really develop that whole, throw to spots, throw little pops in there and whatnot. But he can roll out and throw and break contain. There's the inside handoff, a little bit of a misdirection, but Eric Renault is stopped at the line of scrimmage. Good penetration by the Marauders. Looked like DeGuillar got in there low and the pursuit caught up, so it'll be second and eight. And Ottawa would definitely prefer to be in a lot more second and three, second and four situations where where the defense doesn't know how you're going to attack it, rather than being in second and eight and obvious pass downs with this offense that they're running. But they've picked up the last two with pass plays as they look to get on the scoreboard, break the goose egg, and just have some positives to build off of as this game goes along. Colburn, a little half roll to the left. Throws over the middle, and a great catch by Lamar Kahn in traffic, and a first down down to the 29-yard line. Simone Lamar Kahn with a juggling reception. The leading returning receiver for Ottawa. Three straight completions by Aaron Colburn, and this is how the this offense is supposed to work. I mean, last week the GDs had one completion in the first half for 3 yards. And if you had counted the sack yardage against the passing total, the OUA doesn't do that officially, but they would have had negative passing yards. So a gain of 30. So it's actually down to the 24-yard line. Pickup of 17 on that play. See the GGs go back to the ground, and there's Gillanders on the sweep. Brendan with a cutback, and he's cut down at the line of scrimmage. Aram Ishu got low and sent Gillanders flying to limit the gain. Loss of 2. Again, the GD's starting to execute better in their passing game, you know. But again, they really would prefer some better first down runs. I'm sure. 11:25 to go in the first quarter. Second and 12 for Ottawa. Colburn now fading back, gets some decent protection. Now Aaron is going to have to scramble. He's got wide open, nothing but white stripes. In for a GGTD, Aaron Colburn from 25 yards out. And there you see the special skill set of the kid from Sir Wilfrid Laurier Secondary School. Aaron Colburn came into the game as the number 2 rusher in the OUA. And here he goes 25 yards for a touchdown after the Marauders completely lose contain on that side of the field. And the GGs are back in it somewhat with that touchdown run. 80 yards on that drive. Colburn got it done with his arm, hit 3 completions in a row to march them down, and then picks it up with his legs. A 25-yard scramble for a touchdown. Matt Falvo in, adds the convert, and the score now 23-7. And that drive for the GJs took less than 4 minutes to accomplish. So, I mean, it can move quickly with this offense, especially when they're going into hurry-up mode. It gives this crowd something to cheer about. Definitely got to give got a dueling 50-50 draws today from what I can gather from just watching the crowd, because you've got two high school teams in Carleton Place. You've got the Notre Dame Celtics, and then you've got the Carleton Place Bears. They actually scrimmaged last week. Apparently Notre Dame won 21-0. But it's only a scrimmage, doesn't count. I'm sure the Carleton Place could tell you. But they're both going around selling 50-50 tickets. So it would be, I mean, the best way to would have done it would have made a game of it. Like, you know, who gets more, who sells more 50-50s. I'm sure it's going to be nothing like the 50-50 take you'd get at the World Junior Hockey Championship. That can go into the six figures. Negaleka and Moore back deep for the Marauders as Falvo is to kick off. Negaleka taking it outside the hash marks. He bobbles it, and that ball is loose. The GGs may have it. They do. Lamar Kahn is on it. Second turnover of the day by the Marauders, and the GGs will take over deep in Marauder territory. At the 22-yard line. And they could very quickly cut this margin down to a 2-score game. Tricky wind, and Negaleka could not handle the end-over-end kickoff, and the Marauder defense is right back on the field, and so is the GG offense that just drove 80 yards for a touchdown. And people were saying, you know, this game, you know, Max number 1 in the country, they've scored 118 points in 2 games, Ottawa's 0-2, they've yielded 110, but I just had a feeling this could be closer than a lot of people were predicting. Colburn quickly gets to the line of scrimmage, and Aaron Colburn's going to pass on first down, airing it out for the end zone, and it's intercepted. Ventresca has it, and he's returning it up the far side. He's cut down, and that can be chancy. You always want to go bigger, you know, so there's always that feeling to try to strike quick when you get a sudden change deep in the opponent's territory, but sometimes they're often prepared for that, and Ventresca, you know, got that pass hung in a little in the wind, and Ventresca intercepted it, and of course he's... That is something he's well known for. Made the interception on the in the second overtime in the Vanier Cup last year when the score was tied at 38-all to end the end Lavelle's drive. And, of course, Mack was able to take over, move into position to kick the winning field goal minutes later off the foot of Nepean's own Tyler Crepina. So Kyle Quinlan will start from the 14. Mack's poorest starting field position, but they'll take that over giving up an Ottawa touchdown. There's the, here again, it's Masotti inside on the quick shovel pass. Pardon me, that was actually Tyler Loveday taking it. His first touch of the afternoon, and it's good for a gain of about 3 yards. I think with McMaster's offense, they could legitimately go the whole year without calling a running play. Just substitute all those shovel passes in and then let the quarterback make the rest on his legs. Of course, you're not going to get a quarterback like Kyle Quinlan to come along every time. But he is a special athlete. Sort of had his breakout in back in 2009. That year, Mack beat the Western Mustangs at Western's homecoming, I believe 42-35, and Quinlan accounted for all 6 touchdowns, passed for 3, and ran in 3. People started to realize the native of South Woodsley, Ontario, was indeed something special. So 2nd and 7 for the Marauders. Quinlan looking out to his left, airing it out, has Babich behind coverage, and he hangs on somehow with 3G. No, and then with a late signal, Francois Rodriguez said he was juggling it, and the GGs get the call and get the 2 and out, more importantly, to force Mack to punt and have their offense get right back on the field. Looking to cut into the margin now with 5:04 gone in this quarter. Looked like Babbitt had found that little sweet spot in between the layers of the GG's coverage, but he was juggling it as he went out of bounds. Didn't really see the ball hit the ground, but we'll give it to him. So Tyler Carpina on to punt, averaging just more than 30 yards per kick. Per punt, excuse me. A lot of Marauder fans had a really good are on this side of the field, so they weren't big fans of the call. Pena gets a good snap. Nice punt. That'll back up Vince Campbell. Campbell had one called back last week by a penalty, and there is a flag down on this return as he takes it into Marauder territory before being wrestled down by Kashin Davis Reynolds. But there was a flag. There was a flag down. We'll check that.
Visit the Carter and Gray website at GGs.ca for all information on your Ottawa GGs. Tune into the score tally.
And that's something the GGs definitely want to look at. It looks like it was against McMaster. It's declines. A big return by Campbell, the exciting rookie for the GGs. Slot back. Another one of these, just really polished players out of Quebec. Just a guy who just runs, does clean. They actually pick the flag up. So the GG's taking over in plus territory for the third time today, but the first time they went 2 and out and ended up missing a field goal. The second time they were picked off in the end zone on the first play. See if they can make some hay off of this time. Hand off to Nagundi running right, but again, Aaron Ishu is there and drags it down for a 2-yard loss. I just love the emphatic celebrations that Ishu makes after getting to a tackle, because it's hard enough to locate the ball when you're facing the double wing offense. And if you can fight through the blocks and do it and bring the man down behind the line of scrimmage, what's the saying? You don't pay anyone to be humble. You might as well show off, hey, I did that. The GGs again with another 2nd and 12. The last time they faced this down in distance, Colburn scrambled for a touchdown. 8:30 to go in the first half, 23-7 McMaster. But the GGs have come to life lately. Colburn faking the handoff. He has pressure. A man in his face rolls away from it. Throws, has the completion for a first down into Mack territory. Simon Lamarcand is Mr. Second Down for the moment. Big gain all the way down to the Mack 32. Actually, it's a first down. So Colburn has hit on 4 of his last 5 passes. None of them have been incomplete. The other one was, of course, picked off by Ventresca there after the pass sort of hung in the wind a bit. And again, if the GGs can score here, they will be back in the game. 1st and 10 from the 32. There's the handoff to Mack Tommy. Takes it right into the sideline. That was just, that was a lot of east-west running in a north-south game on that play. The Gigi's, you know, that's sort of been the, even with the Gigi's old offense, they always, you know, tried to set up that rail to the outside to let their tailback cut it up. And at that point in time, the Marauder defense is very quick sideline to sideline. It's really tough to do that against them. So Gigi's, again, second and nine. Their running game's kind of been in neutral, I would say, for the last few series. But Colburn's been able to bail them out some second down completions. This time they run the inside handoff. But the Marauders all over it. Tanvir Bangu and Ben DeGuiller quickly with the stop. The Gigi's are going to be facing a third and long after the inside hand. Tried to just catch them off guard with the handoff to McGee. He picked up five. So this is probably going to be a field goal situation for the Gigi's. Felvo missed from 39 at the other end of the field in the first quarter. It'll be on to try what looks like a 35-yarder once they put the tee down. Colburn to hold. Of course, having the quarterback holding, people will always wonder, are you going to try something? Alan Dix is back very deep in the end zone and could run it out for the Marauders if the kick is indeed wide. Falvo puts it down, and he's on the money. Matthew Falvo hits from 35. 35-yard field goal. That'll cut the margin to 23-10 for the Marauders, who will probably scrimmage from their own 35. So 10 consecutive points from the Gigi's here in the first 8 minutes of this quarter. But again, I'm sure they've had, again, three times they've taken over in MAC territory, after recovering fumbles or after a Campbell punt return, and have only managed to score 3 points off those drives. Their touchdown came off a long drive. Quinlan will start. Puts all four receivers out to the left side. Keeps a tight end in. Looked like some early movement, and that play will be blown dead. Looks like Mack will have a 1st and 15 coming up. Looks like Matt Sewell moved early on the left side of the line. 6:40 to go before halftime. We'll have Jen Elliott from University of Ottawa Sports Informational along to talk about this facility. At halftime, we're just breezing right along here, literally breezing because the wind is right in our face. 1st and 15 for the Marauders, back at their own 30. Quinlan goes back to the more balanced formation, looks out to the right. Good catch by Babich on the turning around and has a gain of about 11 out to the Marauder 41. Officially, they'll give him 9 on the play. So it'll be 2nd and 6. And again, that's just Quinlan just taking what they give him. Especially when the GD's playing maybe some loose coverage there in the long yardage situation. Focusado, who's got 2 MAC touchdowns, is slotted left here on 2nd down. Quinlan with some time, hasn't been pressured too much. Now he's got a scramble, and the Gigi's got a hold of him. And he's down, sacked for the second time, and did the ball come loose? Yes, it did. The Ottawa Gigi's have it. Their second strip sack of the day on Kyle Quinlan, and the 3rd takeaway overall. And now the Gigi's again are getting great field position and a chance for their offense to make this a 1-touchdown game. Gigi's were able to collapse the pocket quickly, and suddenly Quinlan went from having time to having the ball popped out like you know. Colburn, who has the Gigi touchdown, there's another quick handoff inside as they just try to push the pile, and Kevin McGee rumbles close to the 1st down. Yeah, indeed, it's a 1st down run by the 275-pound blocking back. It's too bad the Gigi's aren't getting a game on University Rush, because I remember Dan Duff, who was Western's the glorified offensive lineman lined up at fullback. He's become sort of a folk hero the last few years whenever he gets a touch, and Kevin McGee could be that same kind of character. Again, the Gigi's run the inside handoff, this time for sufficiently less yardage than they did on the 1st down play. But again, if you're a Mac defender, right now Mac's got a couple guys getting up very slowly. Shane Beaton and Tanvir Bangu both look a bit shaken up as they quickly get up the line of scrimmage. Second and eighth coming up for the GGs. McGeeza burst up the middle. Is actually the second longest run the GGs have had in this quarter. It's the longest one if you're counting designed running plays, because Goldman had the scramble there. There's the bit of a misdirection by Gillanders, but the Marauders are all over it. Nick Shortle tripped them up in the backfield. And the GGs lose two. Sort of run that bit of a, I guess it's called a rip motion. Gillanders starts one way, then quickly reverse pivots just before the snap to take the handoff. But they were all over it, and it'll be another Falvo field goal try coming up. This one from about 30 yards out. Actually, it'll be officially 29 as Matthew sets down his kicking tee. Aaron Coleman to hold. Alan Dix drops back in the end zone. Falvo, of course, I believe the last field goal was his 58th of his career. He's been the GG's kicker since he arrived. Gets it down and through. So Falvo 2 for 3 on the afternoon, and the GG's cut the margin to 10 now. They've outscored Mac 13-0 this quarter. Perhaps not a surprise. I mean, this is one of those classic Canadian football games where the team, whoever has the win, scores. All the points have been scored at the west end of the field. Mac scored 23 in the first quarter. The GGs have scored 13 in the second, but with a little, maybe a bit of better execution, might have had more. Mac's quickly going to scramble. He's quickly going to set up, excuse me. Maybe Quinlan will scramble. Hand off goes back to Davis Reynolds. Cuts off the left side. Good pursuit by Ottawa, and Rob Griffiths and company clean it up. Latanzio helping get in, Laverne each getting in there to limit the gain to about 2 yards. Not surprising Mac would go back to the run after having a turnover in the passing game on the last series. 3:25 to go before halftime. Marauders started fast, going out to a 23-0 lead in the first quarter. Kyle Quinlan accounting for all three touchdowns. But GGs have come back. Now Quinlan, and he's going to be sacked. Tyler Sawyer comes in off the backside. Third sack today. And it's go punt team go for the McMaster Marauders. And this is the way the GG defense is designed to work. Under coordinator Corey McDermott, there will be pressure, but you don't know where it's supposed to come from. And they've done their job so far. Three sacks. And of course, on two of them, they forced fumbles. Carpigna now punting quickly to Vince Campbell, whose last return was a good one. Campbell tried a couple of juke moves, but he's going to be quickly wrestled down to the turf. Good cover, very good coverage by the McMaster Marauders. Mark Barucki was the rookie out of London, not fooled at all. Stayed very disciplined and made the tackle. So the GGs will start at the 45. The 3-minute warnings come in with 2:56 to play before half. So GGs have scored 13 unanswered. You know, hopefully we'll get some stats up here at halftime. Again, if the GGs can get a touchdown here, it suddenly becomes very interesting. Of course, Mac, number one in the country, have been in that spot since the first poll of the year. You know, as is their just desserts, defending national champion. They actually did go down up to Laval for a preseason game, but, I mean, people don't read a lot into those results of those non-conference exhibition games, because you never know how much a team plays at sort of its first-string offense and defense. Mac lost that game 28-22. Sort of rotated Quinlan in the first stringers, and then the second string offense with their backup quarterback, Marshall Ferguson, who would probably start on a lot of teams in the OUA. He and O'Connor, the starting receiver, actually both played at Frontenac Secondary in Kingston. They might get confused a little confused at the sight of the GGs, because Frontenac wears the same garnet and gray colors as Ottawa. Of course, the Marauders are very similar with their maroon and white, and I'm sure they would string you up from the goalpost if you refer to it as burgundy. Anyway, first and 10 from the 45 for the GGs after some excellent punt coverage by the Marauders. Goldman's had a decent afternoon throwing the ball, putting it in the air a little more. Quick pitch to Gillanders. He cuts it inside, and Brendan is dragged down from behind by Kareem Ferreira after a gain of about five. Officially, we'll give him four. By the end of the year, we'll be spot on with, you know, whether it was 4 yards or 5 yards or six or seven. First broadcast of the first GG's football broadcast of the year on SSN Canada. But definitely a more positive first half for the GG's than in either of their first two games. There's the inside handoff at first down, and McGee will push the pile and may have the first down out at the center stripe. If not, it's going to be likely a third and short situation. Looks like where they're putting the ball down, he indeed will have it. Kevin McGee, almost a secret weapon. When you see the depth chart, you see a guy wearing 97 listed as the starting fullback. You assume that he's going to be earning his keep just, you know, as a blocker. But indeed, he's had a few carries here in the first half. Now, McGee signaling to the sideline that the GGs are just a bit short. And, of course, they will go for it. This off, just try to push the pile. GGs quickly up to the ball, maybe just trying to catch McMaster napping. And it's a sneak by Colbin. Has the air and will have the first down to the 53-yard line. We're now down to fewer than 2 minutes to play in the first half. GG's looking to make it a one-score game. They've outscored Mac 13-0 in this quarter to get within sniffing distance of the number one team in the nation. Way too early to start talking about upsets, especially with the way the momentum is swung in this game. And with, you know, knowing what we know about Stefan Batasik's coaching acumen and the ability to adjust at halftime. First and 10 for the GG's. I've been used to saying second and 8 quite a lot. There's the pitch to Gillanders. A little bit of a speed sweep to the outside. Breaks through one tackle, but is wrestled down by Kashak and cohorts. Short gain for Aaron Colbin Brendan Gillanders on the play. Second and 8 coming up. Now we're down to 91 seconds before halftime. 1:31 on the clock. Second and 8 for the GG's as they run the double wing itineration of the two-minute drill. Definitely looking to get more points, make this a more manageable deficit at halftime. Colbin, quick throw to Lamar Conk, can't hang on as he's lit up by Joey Capito. Quick slant, and I think it was just a little too far out in front of Simon, and would have been a tough catch, but instead ends up being a tough drop, and the Marauder defense gets the hold they need and blunts some of the GG momentum here with 1:11 left before halftime. And Simon Lamarcon, and this could be critical for the GGs, he's going to take a knee. Might just be a situation where he had the wind knocked out of him. Got lit up there by Joey Capito. Of course, those quick slants to the wide receivers, I mean, the defensive back's eyes will look like saucers when those are thrown, because the receiver, I mean, he's stretched out, vulnerable, rib cage exposed, all that sort of thing. It's often a chance, even if it's a completed pass, it's a chance to lay a pretty big hit. So Falvo will look to try to angle a punt here, pin the Marauders deep as he's punting from the Marauder 51-yard line. Masadi, one of the men back deep for the Marauders. Kick is angled that way. Masadi will take it out the five. Gets past the first tackler. Now he's looking to break it to the outside. Gets by Bond LaPointe, spins off a tackle, and is finally brought down. Looked like Tyler Sawyer got down there in coverage. Bring him down at the 17. 56.6 seconds left in the half. See how the Marauders play this, whether they try to run a bit of a two-minute drill and get in a Kropina's field goal range. You can probably hit from 40 to 45, even with this tricky wind. Or do they just play conservative, try to bleed the clock, and just get into the locker room and regroup? And locker room being a bit of a misnomer, because they're actually changing at the hockey rink, so it's dressing room. Kashin Davis Reynolds gets the handoff. Tyler Sawyer there gets him wrapped up quickly after a gain of about 5 yards, if maybe. Down to 50.7 seconds left in the half. Davis Reynolds is shaken up, and whistles will halt play. Davis Reynolds got off to a very hot start in this contest. Had more than 60 yards on his first four carries alone. The Gigi's have sort of tightened up the defense and Mac kind of gotten away from the ground game a bit, and that's maybe a little bit surprising considering the fact that, you know, they built that big early lead. You'd think they'd just try to go to the ground and then, you know, wait till the Gigi's overloaded against it and then go to and then try to strike deep. Brad Fochichato had, of course, two touchdown catches in the first quarter, 30-yarder, open scoring, then later a 60-yarder, and then Quinlan later added the third McMaster touchdown on a one-yard sneak after a pass interference penalty in the end zone. Second quarter, the GGs came back with a nice long drive, finished off by Aaron Coleman scrambling 25 yards for the major, and then they've since added two field goals by Falvo from 35 and 30 yards to get within 10 points here. Maybe a bit tighter than people thought. There were people saying, oh, this would be a 60. People joking that, you know, the line on this game would be, you know, 40 points if we were betting on it. But, you know, there's, you know, saying in sports, you know, it's never as bad as it seems when it's going bad. It's never as good as it seems when it's going good. And I think that can apply to both of these teams. You know, Ottawa, there's no denying, you know, they have a lot of players back from last season, 20 starters back. Looks like Davis Reynolds, they're working on the right leg there. As he gets a helping hand up off the field. It'd be critical. Mack obviously can ill afford to lose too many tailbacks. Chris Pezzetta, who scored a touchdown last year in that Vanier Cup win, blew out his knee in preseason. Jimmy Hill, who was one of the leading rushers in the OUA through the first 2 weeks, is not dressed today. And now Davis Reynolds is limping out. Max at the scrimmage on second and six now. On their own 22. Quinlan has some pressure coming on his blind side. Goes deep. He's got Fochisato, and he's got the catch into Gigi territory at the 49. That's going to be a 42-yard gain on the play. And by my very poor mental arithmetic, Fochisato is up to about 150 yards on four catches. He's been their moneymaker. And, of course, Mac's a real deep threat is Mike DeCroce. He's had to dress this season due to a foot injury. Quinlan quickly back at the line of scrimmage as the Marauders look for some points before the half. Pressure coming from the right side. Now he's going to pick it up, pull it down, and scramble. First down run by Kyle Quinlan. And finally brought down inside the GG 35. And the yards just add up quickly for Kyle Quinlan. McMaster went into a bit of a lull there, and they're right back to work now with the scramble up the middle by Quinlan and on the heels of that big completion to Fochisato. 28 seconds left before halftime. Mack quickly now down to the 32. They can cover a lot of ground in a very short time. That's why they're a big part of why they're the number one team in the country and a lot of favorite to come out of the OUA at least as the Yates Cup champion and get into the CIS National Championship. Of course, this year the OUA has home field for the Mitchell Bowl against the Canada West champion, and it's sort of a true West-East playoff format with the AUS and Quebec Conference representatives playing off in the UTEC Bowl. And of course, most people expect that to be the Laval Rouge Or, but the Montreal Caribs, a lot of people have them higher on their top 10 ballots than the Rouge Or. Quinlan, he's going to take the quick throw out to the sideline and a completion to Max Cameron. It looks like it's going to be enough, close to a first down. It was just a very quick out. Quinlan just sort of took what was there. 24.7 seconds left in the half. GGs can ill afford to give up a touchdown. Really need to hold Mac to a field goal try and stay within two touchdowns going into the break. It was on a 6-yard gain down to the 26. This is where Quinlan can often use his legs. Their first down, he's got time. Another quick throw to Cameron. Cameron will quickly step out of bounds as he's bumped out by Randy Williams, but that is a first down. And obviously they're maybe setting up the GGs that here, you know, throwing those quick short out, short patterns, and then maybe try to see if they can have run a little out and up to the end zone and get another touchdown on the board. Crowd here quiet, very quiet here as they not making it too much noise to distract the Marauders. There's a fumbled snap. Quinlan's going to have to improvise. Rolls out to the right, cuts inside one man, but Pierre-Yves Laverne is there, and the GGs get his first down stop. And McMaster definitely has a lot to clean up at halftime. I mean, they've had three lost fumbles, and now a fumbled shotgun snap. 12 seconds left, and that's stems some of the McMaster momentum. Now they'll basically have time for maybe one play before they have to bring Crapino out to try the field goal. Pierre-Yves Laverne has to make the tackle, takes a knee. He's back up quickly off under his own power. Now we hear the chance of defense is second and nine for the Marauders on the GG 22. This is obviously a fairly good, I'd say, fairly critical situation in the game. If Max scores here, then it's 30-13 at half if they score the touchdown. And then, it's in route territory. If they don't score at all or only kick the field goal, it's still a competitive game at 26-13. So those 4 points can make, that 4-point swing can make such a difference. Crowd getting some urging here now as they rise up. We've got a few raindrops falling. You see some umbrellas out. Back with three to the field on second down. Quinlan over the top, has a man, and it's incomplete. Oh, overthrew Robert Babick, and the GGs get the stop. So it'll be Crapina on for the field for about a 30-yard field goal. His first try of the day with 8 seconds left before the half, and then the GGs, presuming Crapina makes it, the GGs will probably just kneel it out and go to the locker room, perhaps happy to be within 13 points against the number one team in the country. Although they obviously left some points on the field by settling for field goals instead of scoring touchdowns. Crapina, 2 of 2 on the season. Has a big leg, the Pia native who played for the Myers Riders. It's down, but flat, whistle before the snap, and a flag was thrown deep in the Ottawa end zone. I wonder what that means. Oftentimes when Mac did not get the play off in time. So that's going to push them back. A time count violation inside of the 3-minute warning period, I believe, usually means 10 yards, not instead of 5. So this is going to be now a 40-yard try for Tyler Crapina. He's got the leg for it, and it looks like the wind has actually shifted a little. It's with him. 7 seconds left in the half. Crowd sort of rising here to rile Crapina, but he's got such a very smooth kicking motion. A lot of people liken him to Don Sweet, the former Montreal Alouettes kicker of the 70s, who's now a kicking guru for several place kickers throughout, young place kickers in Canada. Block reset to 8 seconds before the snap. Now we've got it whistles here. Looks like a timeout might have been called. No, time blowing back in. And if Crapina indeed is cool as a cucumber, this is really a test of his unflappability. As the wind's picking up, a bit of a high snap. Crapina gets it down, off, and he has it. 40-yard field goal for Tyler Crapina. The Nepean native with a nice homecoming so far. Deep kickoffs and now a 40-yarder. 4 seconds left in the half. That ends a run of 13 consecutive GG's points. Is that Mac now doubling the GG's, 26-13, and the wind is really whistling hard now across the field right into our Crow's Nest broadcast location. And obviously you can tell a little bit of a few drops of rain coming in. I wouldn't expect Ottawa to do anything here but just try to run out the clock, but with Gary Echeverry coaching, you never presume anything. Maybe they try something, see what happens. Clock will not start till the ball is snapped. Indeed, there's a handoff. And there, It's Dillanders, breaks loose briefly, but quickly brought down by Ben DeGrillar on the misdirection. And that will end the half. So an interesting first half of football. Looked like it was going to be a McMaster Marauder mauling early on in the game, but the GGs made a game of it in the second quarter with some staunch defense and then some creative offense to move the ball. Picked up some crucial second downs, got some points on the field board, but McMaster sort of reasserted themselves before the half and are back out to a 13-point advantage, 26-13. We joined by Jen Elliott from University U Ottawa Sports Information shortly, I believe. Yep. Step aside here briefly. We'll be back in back for the start, just before the start of the second half. 26-13, number one McMaster over the GGs. You're watching GGs football on Streaming Sports Network Canada, SSNCanada.ca.
back. It's my pleasure to be joined by one of the all-time greats in the panel of Ottawa GG's football, Miles Jarrell. Miles played, of course, long time, had long CFL career before that, played for the GG's in 75, 76, 77. Part of that, what Mangus will claim was the greatest Canadian university football team of all time. I won't ask
what you're... You think that, Miles, because, you know, you're a modest guy. The 75, legendary 75 GGs, and people know Neil Lumsden. They just, the names just roll on. Well, first off, Miles, you're doing a color commentary now on AM 900, CHML, and Hamilton for McMaster. So maybe tell us about the situation there. You're commentating from a Marauder perspective for the Hamilton audience, but it's against your old alma mater, so... Must be a bit of a jumble of emotions there.
Yeah, there is, you know, and I get to see a few players from my era, you know, like Joe Clifford is here, my old roommate, and it's great fun to see him. And, you know, I really have mixed emotions because I live and breathe, you know. I still have a GG tattooed on my butt, and I talk about the GGs. I wear my GG clothing proudly. And I broadcast from McMaster. I live in Oakville, and I have a lot of fun and enjoy the CIS still to this day, you know, even though it was called the CIU back when I played. And I think it's great, the promotional aspects of having all the parents out here. And I really enjoyed it, my time in the CIS and the OUA and the OQUIF. And it's sort of cool to watch McMaster, you know, the defending Vanier Cup champions, because I remember when we were the defending Vanier Cup champions, you know, a few years ago, we won't say how old that makes us old, so, you know, and see all the players that, you know, that I played with go on through great careers, and several of them in the Hall of Fame, you know, and in the CFL Hall of Fame and in the GG Hall of Fame, and it's nice to see the stands full, even though we're out in Beckwith County, which is close to nowhere, but it's close to Ottawa, and it's a beautiful facility, and it's great to see that everybody's out here. The stands are all full, and people enjoying the CIS. We would have never had this many people out in 1975 and 76. We very rarely had this many people at a game.
Yeah, and maybe just for, you know, our younger viewers and just, you know, a little bit of a walk to memory lane. You know, talk about some of the luminaries on that 75 team. I mean,
Neil Lumsden, you know, father of Jesse Lumsden, Jeff Avery, you know, there was myself, Rocky DiPietro, guys that played in the Tim Berryman, the Leach brothers, you know, Doug Faulkner, Ian McPherson. Big Al Moffat. Al was one of the best athletes I've ever seen in my life. You know, it was a lot of fun. We had three running backs: Mike Murphy, Bill Harrison, and Neil Lumsden. And Neil was the star, but the two other players, they both played in the CFL. Billy Harrison, who lives in Barrie, Ontario now, and Mike Murphy, who lives in Ottawa. They were just studs in their own right, and to have that many good running backs available to you week in and week out were just an amazing. And having Rocky DiPietro and Jeff Avery as your receivers, they're just big time stars, and it was a lot of fun. And it just, you know, you see where all the kids come from. You go watch them play for the CIS teams and do well, and then, you know, go forward and play in the CFL, and it's fun, and it's just a great way to have lived, and I enjoy being part of it.
Yeah, and it feels like the Ontario University Athletics Conference in particular, you know, has accounted for two of the last three Vanier Cup champions and has had a team in the Vanier Cup three of the last 4 years. It really does seem, from your perspective, it seems like you know, the OUA has really kicked it up a notch maybe in the last 5 to 10 years?
Absolutely. I think that teams like Laval and Calgary have pushed everybody to be better and do a better job of recruiting. And I watch day in and day out. I watch Stefan Potasek, who, you know, who played at Laurier in the OUA, and how he recruits and what he does to get players to come to McMaster. You know, winning the Vanier Cup is you know, good for 3 or 4 years of recruiting, because, you know, everybody wants as a young player to go from, you know, your rep team to your high school to the CIS to the CFL. And you really get noticed a lot more if you win that Vanier Cup.
Yeah, it certainly was one of the great Canadian university football games ever played, Max 41-38. win over Lavelle last year in the Vanier Cup out in Vancouver. I think it's seared more into my memory than the Grey Cup, which was the showcase of the entire weekend. you watched that one. What do you remember most about, you know, what McMaster pulled off to be, I believe, just the fourth team to beat Lavelle and win the Vanier Cup and go on to win the Vanier Cup that season?
Kyle Quinlan's one of the best quarterbacks I've ever seen. And to beat an Ottawa U alumni, you know, Glenn Constantine, the head coach of Laval, is a good friend of mine and an alumni of Ottawa U. So we have a lot of fun discussing Ottawa U days. And, you know, he's a little bit younger than I am, but he's done such a good job. To watch McMaster beat them in double overtime and having every opportunity to beat them in regular time. And, you know, it was a great game. Great heightens of college experience, and all those players have unbelievable experiences to take back with them, because I still remember the Vanier Cup from 1975 and every bit of it and everything we did.
Yeah, and just getting back to sort of these current Marauders, like, how hard is it? I mean, people always say it's one thing to win a championship, but it's even harder to defend it, because sometimes, you know, you start to take things for granted about your team. But how has Mac, through 2.5 games, look to you so far?
Well, you know what, this will be the first time the starters have played into the third quarter, so it's going to be fun watching this second half to see how well Ottawa can do and come back from being down 23-0. It's now 26-10, and watch them get better with every play.
And now, of course, this, your first look at the GGs here, there's sort of a team in transition, new coaching staff, new field. You were talking about, you know, this unique atmosphere here at Beckwith. What do you think about the way the GG sort of, you know, dug themselves a hole, but have come back in this game? And
well, they've come back, and they're looking good, and, you know, it's an unorthodox offense and a little bit strange in defense, but we'll see what happens by the end of the game, and it should be a lot of fun.
And we've got about 30 seconds or so before we reset for the second half. Teams are coming back on the field. Miles, really do appreciate coming in here. Just sort of tell us about what you're doing with the color commentary and how else you're keeping busy.
CHML, you know, I love staying involved with the CIS, and I got an opportunity to do the games with CHML and Ted Michaels. And I appreciate it, and it's a lot of fun, and I really enjoy coming out and talking to the kids and seeing kids like Kevin McGee, you know, who is... I've been somebody I've talked to over the years with Ottawa U, and watching these kids, you know, the kids that come up and become coaches, and they do a really good job, and I really love hanging out and being with the younger generation and watching them grow.
And again, we feel privileged to have, you know, shared some of your experience with us. Really, I thank Miles. Thank you for coming on, Miles, and enjoy the rest of the game, and have good luck with the rest of the CHML broadcast. And you guys do every game, I believe,
yeah,
right? Home and away?
Yeah.
Excellent.
So, thanks very much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
We have another guest here joining us shortly, as promised, Jennifer Elliott, University of Ottawa Sports Information. Jen, just tell us how but maybe go back to the beginning.
The response from the facility managers here, and we've been working very closely with the entire, actually, town council of Beckwith, and they've been incredibly accommodating and just a great group of people to work with. And I think they have a very special facility here. I don't know how much of the area around the camera is actually capturing, but there's about 15 other grass soccer fields around here. They've got two ball diamonds. It's a pretty cool place. So.
Yeah. And are you pleased by the turnout today? It looked like we got a pretty pretty full down on the bleachers on our side of the field, and then across the field you've got the jockey club right in behind the Mac bench. Good planning by someone there.
I think it's been a great response, especially from the community people who are here from Beckwith to check out. And I know a lot of them were coming to the games even at Lansdowne, but it's nice to be able to bring it to them, and they can expand the members of the family that can come to the game. And the jockey club is definitely representing full force today. They had 4 busloads of students, and we had buses going from campus just for anyone who was interested. So we want to see the same amount of turnout, hopefully, next week for Laurier. That'll be a great game as well. And I think it's been a very good day so far.
Yeah, and then just like that, just as you were coming on, the sun came out. Thank you so much, Jen, and best of luck with the rest of the game.
Official handshake.
That was Jennifer Elliott from University of Ottawa Sports Information. Of course, we had Miles Garrell, GG football alumnus, part of that 1975 Vanier Cup championship team. Of course, GGs have 2 Vanier Cups in their history. They also won in 2000. That team was, of course, quarterbacked by Phil Cote, one of the great quarterbacks in Canadian university football history. Won a heck Creighton in 1999. Of course, Brad Sinopoli, of course, from Ottawa, won it in 2010 as well. So we're back for the second half shortly. Mac received to start the first half. That doesn't always mean they necessarily mean Ottawa will receive to start the second, because the CIS uses the same rules as the NCAA. You can defer your option and whatnot. We're going to try to get some out-of-town scores from throughout the country as we go along. Queens in the Beamer Bowl down in Kingston. Queens is leading Western 7-3 at halftime, which means that Pat Shea and Queens coach, he said on the OUA football coaches teleconference call this week that he anticipated a high-scoring game, like some sort of 45-41 barn burner. But indeed, it's 7-3 for the Golden Gales over the Mustangs in a game that will probably go a long way to deciding the 2 semifinal byes in the OUA. Everyone's sort of seeding first place to McMaster, but the Gales and Mustangs, the longtime rivals, they've been playing each other in football since 1929. Although not continuously, because there was that long stretch where the Gales, and along with the GGs, and of course the original Carleton Ravens, were all in the old Ontario-Quebec Intercollegiate Football Conference. GGs indeed are receiving to start the second half. Randy Williams is back deep. Returned by Vincent Campbell, cuts it to the outside, and is quickly wrestled out of bounds by Nebeleka, who had that fumble in the first half on returns, but redeems himself there with a decent tackle at the 28, where the GGs will start. Elsewhere in the country, of course, it's interlock weekend between the Atlantic University Sport Conference and the RSAQ. St. Mary's up 13-10 on Sherbrooke. Of course, the Montreal Carabin, who many people think can break Lavelle's 9-year hold on the Dunsmore Cup, are leading the Bishop's Gators 21-0. Of course, the indispensable Canada football chat helping us keep updated. They respot the ball at the 29 as the GGs start. Colbin, he had the GGs' lone touchdown of the first half, running the ball. Colbin now rolling, turns back to pass, has to tuck it, and he'll be sacked. Marauders stand up there on the first play, and Tanvir Bangu has himself a sack. And every time it's like a 1 or 2 yard sack, I always think back to my days covering the Queens Golden Gales for CFRC, and I think it was one defensive lineman who shall remain nameless. That game, he thought he had a couple sacks because he had tackled the quarterback on play similar to the one you just saw, except that he brought him down like 1 or 2 yards beyond the line of scrimmage, making it officially a running play. And he's like, "Oh, I'm gonna talk to the stat guy to recording that as a sack," even though it actually was a gain of yardage. So the GGs again, another second and long situation. They hand it off to Frank Nagundi. Frank cuts inside one tackle, and he's running loose and has the first down, moving the sticks for the GGs out to the 40.
First down for the GGs.
Frank Marvell Nagundi picks up 11. Maybe that's this might sound a little derogatory. It's almost like a high school style play, second and long yardage. Give it to one of your fastest ball carriers on an outside play and see if he can turn the corner. But Marvell Nagundi made just a terrific cut there and picked up the first down. And the GGs look to be on the march here as they move out to the 40 and try to get it to be a one-touchdown game. There's the misdirection play. Mac Tommy is stopped up behind the line. Good support by Mack, and it will be a loss of one. If you're looking, of course, if you're looking for some non-CIS football news, apparently the Nail Yakupov, the number one pick in the NHL draft, has been assigned to the Sarnia Sting of the OHL, which is interesting because he said he's never going back to Sarnia. Of course, that's my regular beat with Yahoo Sports covering the Canadian Hockey League. Second and 11 at the 39 from the 39 for the GGs. They've faced numerous second and longs here. Colbin with his protection breaking down. Aaron has to scramble, gets it off. The tough catch, and it's incomplete. He's going for Frank Nagundy on that play. Actually, excuse me, it's Tristan Bailey had just been subbed into the game. Native of Manitick, played it for the St. Mark Lions. So the GGs get one first down before stalling, and they'll have to give it back to the Marauder offense, which was rolling pretty well in the first half. We didn't get any chance to get stats at halftime, unfortunately. But we can tell you that Kyle Quinlan accounted for three touchdowns, and Brad Fogisato had latched onto two touchdown passes, and probably had somewhere in the neighborhood of 150 yards receiving. Falvo on to kick. Nebeleka and Masadi back deep. Masadi will take it from the 35. Good coverage by the GGs, and he's dragged down by Kevin Hansen, the rookie linebacker out of Edmonton. And of course, Kevin Hansen, one of two notable Kevin Hansens in Canadian intramural sport. Of course, the other being the basketball coach of the UBC Thunderbirds. And of course, Ottawa University sport devotees would know him well because the Thunderbirds were regulars whenever at the CIS Final Eight when it was held at Scotiabank Place 3 years in a row. And of course, it's back there this year. Quinlan quickly opening in first half. Quinlan will throw the quick hitter to Babick. Makes a cut, gets out close to the 50-yard line before he's dragged down by Francois Rodriguez. But it's enough for a first down. And again, the Marauders, they had two turnovers in the first half, both fumbles by Quinlan after being sacked. So I think they really want to establish that quick passing game, get the GGs back on their heels a little. But again, Ottawa plays a unique defense. They started it last year, sort of called the Joker front, and there might only be two offensive linemen. There's the handoff to Davis Reynolds, who's back in the game after being shaken up in the first half. Tyler Sawyer in there to help limit the gain. It'll be about a 4-yard pickup for Cassine Davis Reynolds. Native of Mississauga, played at St. Francis Xavier Secondary, and there's an Ottawa connection there because their wrestling coach, Jason Cormier, is an Ottawa native. I know that's an obscure fact, but we'll go with it. Second and six for Quinlan. Quinlan looking left. Throws a little bit behind his man, but it's caught for the first down. Good job by Babich. Officially, Fogisato announced for the catch, actually. 82 and 83, tough to tell apart with those McMaster uniforms. So the Marauders in motion here. First down at the GG 50 as they look to take the lead out to 20 points. They've led by as much as 23 in this game. The GG's made a run in the second quarter. Quinlan with time. Has Latanzio flushing him out to the right. Lofts it deep, but overshoots Ben O'Connor. And for a rare time today, the GGs are able to stop Kyle Quinlan. Looks like Christopher Pickard might be shaken up for the Marauders, their right tackle. Those scramble situations aren't always good for linemen. Actually, Pickard actually blew a shoe there. He's getting it back on. He'll be fine. GGs run substitutes in and out now as they put McMaster in the second and 10 situation, and they haven't done that probably enough today. And considering Quinlan came into the day averaging close to 11 yards per pass attempt, you really want him in second and long as often as possible, just as you would with any quarterback, but especially him. There's the play action, lofting it deep. Fogisato dropped. Good coverage by the GGs. Tyler Sawyer ranged downfield to take away that seam pattern, and the GG defense holds and will bring up a punting situation for McMaster. And now after getting some rain in the first half, the sun's come out, and it's a beautiful afternoon for football here at Beckwith Park. And again, beautiful facility. I mean, this has pretty much got anything you would get if you get living in the suburbs. Rapinoe with some pressure on from the right side. Bit of a short punt. Bounces down. Looks like it hit a McMaster player, and if indeed it did, that's a no-yards penalty. And would bring the ball probably out to around the 40. Huge break, a potential huge break for the GGs, pending the resolution of the penalty. 10:09 to go, third quarter. Ottawa's defense with a good stand on the first McMaster series of the third quarter. Yet they are marking it off as no yards. As referee Al Kirkpatrick signals it to both sides. So the GGs are going to get the ball in the 42. So only a net of 13 yards on the exchange. And again, another break for Ottawa. But so far today, whenever they've been given good field position by a McMaster mistake, they haven't fully capitalized. Their only touchdown came on a long, long drive. There's the quick handoff to Gillanders, trying to get outside, being chased by Ferreira. Good blocking out in front by Aaron Colbin, and he'll pick up about five. As Gillanders has run out of bounds. They've got some security fencing close to the sideline, but not as tight a sideline as you'd see at Hamilton's venerable Ivor Wynne Stadium. Incidentally, if you haven't gotten down there to Ivor Wynne, get down there before the end of the season, because you'll never see a stadium like that again anywhere in Canada. Maybe not anywhere in North America or the Western world. It's like an old sort of neighborhood soccer ground in England. Second and five for the GGs after that five-yard run by Gillanders. Looks like they might go to again. Now it's Colbin faking. Colbin has some room around the right side. Pulls up and throws and gets the completion to Nagundi. He breaks one tackle, taking it deep into McMaster territory and down to the 35-yard line. And he's been the long yardage man this afternoon for the GGs. A couple big runs from scrimmage and now a big-time reception down to the 35. 28 on the play, and the GGs are on the cusp of the red zone. And again, that first down run by Colbin, Gillanders really set up the pass by Colbin. Basically, they were able to sort of fake a similar looking play, bought AC time to roll out. Now the GG's looking to cash in here. Again, it's Colbin on the play action, has McGee out in front blocking, throws, but it's dropped, and there is a flag! And that will be pass interference, surely. And we'll move the GGs a little bit closer. Maximum 50. Yep, indeed, it's pass interference. Now we'll move the ball down to the 21-yard line. First PI flag of the day on the Marauders. The GGs had one on their defense in the first half that actually set up the third MAC touchdown. But, and I'm not saying it was only because of that. Mack had obviously made the drive and was in position to score. So the GGs get some help after catching McMaster in a position. Flags down before the snap, and this may be a procedure call against the G's as they look to get back within a touchdown of McMaster for the first time since about, the four-minute mark of the first quarter. Mack got out up on top 16-0, barely 7 minutes into the game. The GGs have steadily whittled away at it, and indeed it is a five-yard walk-off after an illegal procedure against the GGs. So first and 15. Those are the penalties you hate to have when you get into the score zone. You never want to go backwards at all. You never want to go backwards at any time, but especially when you're sort of backing teams up and getting them on the run. And the GGs, of course, have twice settled for a field goal from Falvo after driving deep into MAC territory. There's Colbin on the roll, has some time, and overthrows his man, misses Mac Tommy, and now the GGs will face a second and 15. And Tommy was fairly wide open on that crossing route. See what the GGs try. We've seen them a couple of times try to sneak in a run on second and long. Because, I mean, as Gary Echeverry says, you know, he doesn't worry about whether the yards come by air or by ground. He just wants yards are yards, to him in this offense, but you'd think Colbin would be going to the air here. Colbin quickly throws the screen to Lamar Kahn, but the Marauders quickly sniff it out, and they'll limit the gain and bring up a field goal situation. And I think the problem there was on a screen pass, you never want the defensive lineman to release sort of inside of you if you're the for the tackle. But that time there was pressure coming up the middle, and Colbin wasn't able to just, you know, drop it in there to Lamar Kahn. And as a result, the Marauders hold, and they'll bring up Matthew Falvo's fourth field goal try of the afternoon. He's 2 for 3, hit from 35 and 30, missed from 39. Simone Lamar Kahn a little late getting off the field. But it's officially, it's going to be about a 30-yard try. Matt got a little pressure off the edge, but the field goal is good, and the GG's line back within 10. That's as close as they've been since Matt got off to the big lead. 7:13 to go in the third quarter. 26-16 now for the Marauders. GG's hanging in there. This game closer than people might have expected. There were people, like I say, people were thinking this was going to be, you know, wipeout city. The Marauders won their first two games by a combined average of 88 points. The GGs lost their first two by a combined, if my math is good, 56 points. Quinlan, two touchdowns in the first half, but he also lost two fumbles. There's the quick shovel pass to Babick. He's going to have the first down before he's run down by Robert Griffiths. And Babick is shaken up on the tackle. Gains 12. And you know, now you know why Quinlan had a 74% completion percentage coming into this game. I mean, he's basically just throwing chest passes to Babick running in front of him. I mean, those are shorter than the throws I make at the gym with the medicine ball. Hand off to Cassine Davis Reynolds, and a huge hole through the B gap, bounces off a tackle, and has the first down all the way down to the GG 47 before Matt Von LaPointe makes the stop. And the Marauders moving like they did early in the game, and if that trend continues, it would be bad news for the GGs, since Matt marched up and down the field like the Stanford Band in the first quarter. When Leonard goes back to Reynolds, the flag is down. Actually, it's a play fake, and he's got Cameron behind coverage, and he'll take it in for the score, but we'll check the flag. There are flags down on both sides of the field. And judging by the McMaster reaction, this play will not stand. Probably an offside on the Marauders. It's on the GG. It's declined, and the touchdown stands. Touchdown for Max Cameron. Believe that might be one of his first of the season for the rookie receiver out of Dennis Morris in St. Catharines. So there's the response the Marauders were looking for. 75-yard drive. I believe all four of their touchdown drives have covered at least 70 yards this afternoon. With the convert, Carpinha, they're now up 33-13. And yes, indeed, Tyler Carpinha has kicked a convert that went onto the baseball field next to the football stadium. We were joking about that in the first half. He's actually done it. Although I think it bounced over, so actually that's just an automatic double, not a home run. So that takes some of the starch out of the GGs and some of the wind out of this crowd, which had sort of heated up as the GGs chipped away at the lead. Perfect time to play some Hathaway. Vince Campbell and Randy Williams are back deep up for the kickoff. Vince Campbell came into the day leading the OUA in kickoff return yards with 214. Just an exciting player. I think GG fans will really get to know him, love over the next few years. People cheering for Tyler Carpinha to just boot this one into the end zone. GG's basically overhauled their kick return team. Soonbom Cha took a couple back in the first half, but got buried deep, and now Campbell looking for a hole to the outside, and he'll just wrestle down inside the 15-yard line. There is a flag down on the play, down at center field.
The all-time career field goal
Yeah. And of course, we're getting a warm ovation from the crowd announcing that Matt Falvo has set a new University of Ottawa record for career field goals. He's made three today. And that's just a testament to just the dedication, you know, and durability of the GG's fifth-year kicker. He's done both jobs in his entire career. We're going to have a re-kick as McMaster was offside. This gives the GG's a chance to get some better field position, always make them kick it again. You know, because those coverage guys, after they sprint down there, you know, they're usually pretty winded. And then they'll have to sprint down again. There's always a chance you could bust a big return. So Carpino will kick off this time from the 40. Elsewhere in the OUA, the Windsor Lancers are bounced back big time from their loss to Guelph. They're up 31-4 in Toronto. This time it's the short kickoff. Bounce down to around the GG 25. Bit of a hole there briefly for Pierre-Yves Laverne, but he's wrestled down at the 35 by McMaster's Joseph Richardson. Actually, look at him, the 33 on that play. It's the second time you've sort of seen the short kickoff by Mac. The last time they did that, they actually gifted the GGs with some decent field position, and Ottawa went on to score on that drive. Not saying that's an omen, just saying that's what happened. Elsewhere, too, at halftime, we mentioned the Waterloo Warriors haven't won a game since they returned to OUA football last year, but they're tied 10-10 with Guelph. The Guelph Griffins, of course, you know, a team that looked to be on the cusp of becoming a power for a while, but haven't quite been able to deliver. There's a handoff to Gillanders, and Brendan with good yardage up the middle for about 8 yards before he's brought down, and that's more of what the GGs need. Actually, mark it at about 6. Our producer, Matt Copeland, just never stops working as we're working here in the second half. Dealing with a lot of wind, dealing with weather, dealing with an unusual stadium configuration. Gigi's on 2nd and 6, pitched to Nagundi, and he's going off that right side where he's made big yards today, but this time the Marauders are on it, and Ishu knocks him out of bounds, shy of the first down by about 3 yards. So not much gain. In the other OUA game, the Laurier Golden Hawks, who started off the year 0-2, up 17-3 on York. Laurier looking to get their first win of the year, obviously. York came in at 1-1 after beating the GGs last week. And as we mentioned, that was York's first win in 8 years over a team that's not Toronto or Waterloo. Warren Craney doing a great job with that program, and along with Michael Falls, the former Western quarterback and all-time leading passer in yardage in CIS. Threw for more than 10,000 in his career at Western. Falvo on to punt. Falvo with a pretty good, a decent boot. That's going to bounce. GGs have to avoid the no-yard situation. They do, but it looks like an opportunity for a return for Masadi, and he's across center field to the GG 53 before being tackled, and that's... And the GG Mac will probably get close to their best starting field position of the afternoon, starting in plus territory at the 53-yard line. Maybe that's a situation where... You just take the no yards and limit the damage to 5. Laurier, meanwhile, has been their margin lead over York's now been cut to 17-6. Quinlan, touchdown, Pat, 3 touchdowns today on the last drive. Still no picks on the season, although he did lose 2 fumbles in the first half. Davis Reynolds, nice cut off the right side. Actually, Quinlan's kept it and runs for 6. So that's the second time Kyle Quinlan has fooled me. And maybe fooled the GG defense, although they limit the gain to about 7 yards on the play. Still decent first down yardage for Mac. Davis Reynolds checks out. Marauders overload the left side of the field. They now empty the backfield out for Quinlan. Sometimes where you see him take the quarterback out, there's the quick throw, but he overshoots Robert Babick. Intended for Focus Shadow. and it'll be a punting situation for the Marauders. And this is where you kind of wonder, third and three in plus territory, up by 17, late in the third quarter now, 3:51 to go. And as Miles Gorrell mentioned in our halftime interview, this is probably the deepest into the game that Mac's starters have played. This is probably maybe fake good prime fake punt territory, but instead Carpina's going to kick it away, and he shanks it. I don't even think that barely got by the line of scrimmage, and indeed it's an 8-yard punt. So again, Mac tried to run the punt team out there, kick quickly, and it backfires terribly. Officially, it's actually even worse than I said. It's 4 yards after the officials first stepped, marked it off at the 38, and then walked it up a few yards. But yeah, that was maybe a classic instance of outsmarting yourself a little. Mac tried to get the punt team out there very quickly and did not work. The GGs start from the 42 now. They look to get back into it, down to 3:40 in what's been a fast-moving third quarter. GGs got pared down the margin to 10 with a Falvo field goal, but the Mac came right back with a touchdown to Max Cameron. Pitch out to Nagundi, cuts it inside, gets up behind the block from service, has the first down, and Frank's still running out to the across center stripe to the 54. So first and 10 at the 54. That was a gain of 14. Frank Marvell, Nagundi has to be close to about 100 yards, even though he's only had maybe 7 or 8 carries. There's the quick inside handoff. Dillinders on a bit of a search play will have a gain of about 5. Gain 6, 5 or 6 on the play. That was tough running inside by Dillinders. Second and 4 for the GGs. They look to get draw closer. There's another inside handoff. Dillinders bounces it up the middle and pushes the pile for a first down behind the blocking of Adam Velchuk. Looked like DeGuillar was in on the tackle. First down for the GGs after back-to-back runs by Brendan Dillinders. Down to the Mac 42. See if we see Kevin McGee get the ball again. This time it's play action. Colvin on the roll. Good protection. Going downfield. Has Campbell behind coverage, but Ventresca's there for his second interception of the day. And a nice return by Ventresca. Still going. And he's got blockers in front of him. Finally chased down at the GG 47. And for the second time today, Stephen Ventresca comes up with the pick to thwart a GG drive. Might be a candidate for defensive player of the game, at least on the Marauder side of the ball. And a nice run back, too, as well. Mac's going to start at the 49. Initial spot was the 47. Mac quickly up to the line of scrimmage as they look to take advantage of the turnover and maybe sort of stick a fork here in the GGs. You've seen Davis Reynolds, nice spin move to get away from Trevor Seal. Still going, first down the left sideline, one man to beat, and he is gone for the touchdown. 49 yards, Cassine Davis Reynolds. Maybe a star is born. Oh, they're going to mark him out. Excuse me, got a little exuberant there. Didn't see that. It's going to be 43 on the play. That puts Reynolds over 100 yards, and if there's any justice in the world, he'll get a chance to put this one in the end zone. It's a bit of a late signal marking him out, but what a burst as he got down the 30 sideline. That made a great move in the backfield. Trevor Seal read the play correctly, got in there. He made a great spin move in the backfield. So basically, 43-yard run and about 45 yards after contact. And apologies, I've been off on a few calls today. A little bit of an adjustment, not to make any excuses, but of course you have the great view at Lansdowne Park from up there, professional press box. You're down a lot closer to field level here at Beckwith. Of course, we're just up sort of on this scaffolding. And sometimes things you took for granted at Lansdowne, you don't quite see here, and I miss the official signaling him out of bounds. Injured Gigi on the play. It looks like it might be actually Griffiths. Actually, it's Trevor Seal, 35 and 55, can be really similar from this vantage point. Pierre-Yves Laverne will check in at the defensive end spot here as Mac goes back to work. First and goal from the six. Quinlan looking for his fourth touchdown of the day. Gets it to Focasado, spins off a tackle, but Rodriguez wrestles him down, but not before he gets to the one-yard line. 5 yards. Gain of five down to the one. Last time Mac was down here, Quinlan snuck it in. He's got two touchdowns to Focasado today, another one to Max Cameron. He's run one in himself. And as we move down to less than a minute here in the third quarter, you'd assume he's going to do the same thing. And he does. Touchdown McMaster. Two on the ground for today to call Quinlan to go around, along with the three by air. And the Marauders have a chance to take a 24-point lead and move this game into safe territory. With 44 seconds left in the third quarter. Looking like the Marauders are going to pull away after scoring back-to-back touchdowns. Rapina adds the extra point. He's 5 for 5 today. 40-16 now for the Marauders. I think everyone expected them to score 40. Gigi's, of course, home next week against the Laurier Golden Hawks, and that probably will be a must-win game if the score holds and the Gigi's fall to 0-3. Laurier looking to come in. Laurier right now is winless but ahead of the York Lions, so they could both teams be at 1-2. Really, the Gigi's would have to win that game to have any realistic shot at making the playoffs in the OEA, where 6 of 10 teams go on to the second season. Out-of-town score from Kingston in the third quarter now. It's 11-10 for Western. Western just had a scoring opportunity sliding down the river when they had seven consecutive runs to get in scoring range, and then Donnie Marshall tossed an interception to end the drive and the scoring threat. Here's Crepina to kick off. Got a bit of a win behind him now. Down to Vincent Campbell. Campbell from the four. Looks to attempt a middle return. Brakes has to cut back. Breaks through one wave of tackles. Now Campbell's into the open field, and he fumbles, and the Marauders have it. Campbell was looking to break a big return and got hit from behind, and the ball was popped out. They're still sorting it out down there, but I think it looked like the ball ended up under a pile of white shirts and not a pile of garnet shirts. They're wrestling down one of the officials right down there, almost like a wrestling referee on the mat. But I think the Marauders got... Nope, Gigi stayed on top of it. That's the signal from the Ottawa players. And consider a bullet dodged. I really thought McMaster had more men and go down into that pile. But Ottawa, the ball's rolling around down there. Someone got onto it and spared the Gigi's from... disaster. We're down to 30 seconds. Ottawa down 40-16. So they'll start from their own 38 after a 33-yard run back by Vincent Campbell. Again, he made some great moves, made a great stop and start there just inside the 15 to get away from Niglaka and break into the open field. And you can see why they're so excited about him, and just didn't quite secure the ball. Nagundi, and he's tripped up behind the line of scrimmage. Nick Shorthill shot the gap and wraps Frank up for a big loss. It's going to be second and 14 as we move down to what will be the final play of the third quarter. 40-16 McMaster. They're in control of this game now. Kyle Quinlan's accounted for all five Marauders touchdowns. GGs have only been able to hit Pater once. And that was Aaron Colbin on a scramble back in the second quarter. So second and 14, back of the 34. Had a fun afternoon no matter what, and then we get play stopped before the snap. Another CIS out-of-town score from one of the Atlantic-Quebec interlocking games. 28-13, Concordia's up on St. Francis Xavier. St. Mary's still ahead up on Sherbrooke, 16-10 in the third quarter. Meanwhile, the GG's second and 14 here. A little bit of an inside handoff and close to a first down, but not close enough. As they went to Tristan Bailey on that play, second rush of the game. So that is the end of the third quarter. Bailey picked up seven, but that was only half of what they needed. We're through three quarters here at Beckwith. 40-16 McMaster as they look to nail down the win and preserve their perfect record and number one ranking in CIS for at least another week. So GG's third and seven, and Falvo on to punt. I mean, it would be quite a streak for McMaster. I mean, I'm struggling to think of the last time they didn't score at least 40 points in a game. They did it in all four playoff games last year. 40 on Queens in the semifinal, 41 on the Western Mustangs in the Yates Cup, 45 on Acadia in the UTEC Bowl, and 41 on Lavelle in the Vanier Cup. And people said, well, that game went to overtime, but they had a little extra time. But still, I mean, you don't see Lavelle ever give up 41 points. In fact, I believe that might have been the first time anyone went over 40 on Lavelle since that great St. Mary's team Blake Neal had in 2001. With Ryan Jones at quarterback, Louis Perez at tailback. Dave Stalla, of course, the current Hamilton Tiger Cats receiver, was on that team. Still active in the CFL here in 2012. They were a steamroller. Like I say, of course, they only played three playoff games, so they didn't get a chance to match Maxfield, but they also scored 40 in all three playoff games. Gigi's have an onside man for this punt as Falvo kicks it high. Masadi takes it at around the 39. Gigi somehow stayed under the no-yard zone. Masadi gets up to about the 47 before he's wrestled out by Randy Williams and Pierre-Yves Laverne. See how long the Marauders stick with Quinlan. 24 points with a quarter to go is a safe lead. Marshall Ferguson, the Marauders' number two quarterback, he's been in every game this year. Well, there's only been two so far, but he's played extensively, is what I'm trying to say. There's a handoff to Moore, and the GGs blow it up. Chris Daly comes up on the blitz and knocks him down. Loss of two. One of the first probably negative yardage plays for the Marauders in quite some time, other than the sacks that the GGs had in the first half. Second and 13, they're going to call it. Quinlan looking to pick this up. He's got three touchdowns in the air. They no interceptions, so we now eight touchdowns, zero picks on the year. There's the quick throw, and it's caught by O'Connor, but well short of the first down. That was a dangerous pass to the wide side as Zach Rayner came up to make the tackle, and that'll bring up a punting situation. And a nice play by Rayner to read that and fight through the block. Maybe Mack was looking to have O'Connor make the yards after the catch. Of course, you can't block. Of course, the other receiver downfield can't block until the pass is completed. So Carpigna, whose last punt went just 4 yards, he's got pressure at the middle. Much better kick this time, angling it toward the sideline, out of bounds, inside of the GG 30, and marked at around the 28. With 13:53 left.
OUA recognizes the following corporate partners for their continued support: Wilson Sports Canada, Pioneer Pioneer Energy, Pizza Pizza, Bel Air Direct, Investors Group, Westmont Hospitality, Porter Airlines, Big Kahuna Sports Company, the Score Television Network, and the Government of Ontario.
So the GGs will get another chance to get on offense. Just, I think this has been a more respectable showing for the GGs than people expected, but you can sort of see the little, you know, buffs and dents in their, the little dents and nicks in their game that they need to buff out before the end of the season. Obviously didn't execute in the score zone as well as they could have, settling for some field goal tries by Falvo. Obviously some blown coverages on defense early in the game that put themselves into way too big a hole. Here's Colbin, and he is sacked. Short Hill came in unblocked, and then the ball came loose. That may be a turnover. And that, and Colbin was completely unprotected. Gigi's got back on top of the ball, thankfully for them. That's the only positive that could come out of that play. It's going to be second down and about 18. Looks like Western's still up on Queens, but it's close there. So second and 18 for the GGs, back at the 20. And after again, Colbin to throw over the middle. Lamar Khan's open, makes a good cutback. We'll have the first down because he's got some good blocking out in front of him. And an alert play by Simone Lamar Khan. Mike wasn't going to get the first down if it continued straight up the field. Gave a little ground, waited for the block to develop, and moves the sticks. And the GGs get out of the hole with a 21-yard gain. And again, if the GGs can score here, Gary Echeverry is over talking with Colbin quickly as he consults with the, with the coaches. There's been a bit of a delay on the field. 12:37 to go. The GGs score here. They're probably in the at the point where they probably need to go for some two-point conversions just to try to pare down the margin. Get back with in distance. Great job by Colbin just to stand in there and deliver after taking a big hit on the previous play. Aaron rolling right. He's got pressure coming from DeGuillard, and he'll be sacked. Ben DeGuillard with the takedown. A huge loss back to the 35. And again, so two sacks on this series by the Marauders, one by Shorthill, one by DeGuillard. That's just a big active force unit by the Marauders. And again, protection problems by the GGs. They are actually sort of huddling here a bit. Lamar Khan checks out for the second down play. Ian Stewart comes in at wide out. Second and 16 from the 35. GGs haven't done too badly at their second and long conversions. But the problem is they've had way too that faced that scenario way too many times. A little bit of trickery and misdirection here, but Nagundi is going to be brought down shy of the first down. Gets back to the original line of scrimmage. But again, now we bring up a punting situation for the GGs, so those two sacks. Just to finish the thought, those two sacks help blunt the GG's momentum and they force them to give the ball back to Matt. Okay. Again, it's Negaleka and Masadi back deep to receive the punt. Falvo's kicked, had a pretty good day kicking in all facets, of course. Those three field goals make him the school's new career leader in field goals. Falvo backing Negaleka up, back to his 20, kick takes a bounce. Bobbles it a little, and he'll be run out down at around the 17 or 18 yard line. Dustin Wilson, the Ottawa native, down in coverage to make the tackle. And again, the GGs just, you know, trying to look for some positives in these remaining 10 minutes and 52 seconds here. I mean, I don't think anyone was really expecting Ottawa to stun the university football liking world by beating McMaster today, but it certainly 24 points is a closer margin than many anticipated, even though it has seldom been in doubt, really, since Matt took that 23-0 lead early. Quinlan with three to the field on first down, throws the quick hitter to Focasado. He's being wrestled down to the ground by Rodriguez and a host of garnet-shirted GGs. Decent gain on first down. Another halftime score. Our game starting out in Western Canada. Calgary, number two in the country, the new number two team in the country, only leading number seven Manitoba, 9-8 at half. There's the shovel pass to Babick as he looks for the first down. He's got a hole, and Babick's down the left sideline, is finally wrestled and loses the football, but it bounces out of bounds, fortunately for McMaster. And now Robert Griffith is a little shaken up at the end of the play, but it looks like he's going to be okay. But a gain of 24 on the play for Babick, and that's been the best running play Max had all day. Well, Sean Davis Reynolds has actually gone for more than 100 yards today, but that speed shovel pass to Babick underneath has really given the GGs trouble. And now Robert Griffith is going to go down and get some attention from the trainers. Might have just sort of cramped up or tweaked something. But he's someone the GGs can ill afford to lose. Very astute middle linebacker. They marked that ball at the 53-yard line. They're in the fourth quarter now, down just to the south of us in Kingston. Western still up 11-10, but Queens apparently just took over in Mustang territory after snuffing out a third down gamble. And since we're in Beckwith, we should mention that Sam Sabern, Queens star linebacker, played for South Carleton in high school, the South Carleton Storm. Apparently having a big game, but Hales haven't been able to move on the Western defense much. And again, that game will likely decide one of these semifinal spots. If everything goes according to form, you know, McMaster, a lot of people thinking the Marauders can run the table or go no worse than 7-1. And that Queens or Western, each of those teams may finish at least 6-2. Although I wouldn't rule out Windsor. They're a very dangerous team. Maybe just not too consistent. There's Wayne Moore, bounces off the tackle at the line of scrimmage and has a decent gain before he's brought down. Bond LaPointe came up from his spot at safety. But he gets to the second level and gets about 9 yards on the play. Of course, Davis Reynolds was shaken up earlier. Mac's been having some injury problems at tailback. So I wouldn't be surprised if you see a bit more of Moore as this game goes on. I'm actually going to measure here for the first down, but I don't. But judging by where the down my head, it looks like it's short. Short by inches, or either he might have it, actually. No, second down. Second and academic, you might as well call it, because no one. It's very rare to see a team not pick it up when it's that close. 9:30 to go in this game. Marauders, I'd say, played with fire a little bit in this one. Ottawa twice climbed to within 10 points after the Marauders went out to a 3-touchdown lead, but now Max reaffirmed itself. Quinlan bobbles the snap, broken play. He's just going to run out to his left, runs through the first tackle and has the first down before he's brought down by Lavras, the defensive end. So, well, Quinlan, even when Mac doesn't execute, Quinlan bails them out. First down on the 40. 9 minutes, 11 seconds to play. Again, no, we don't have official stats on Quinlan, but you got to think he's in the 300-yard range for passing. He's thrown 3 touchdowns. There's the quick hitter underneath the Focasado. Gain of about 8 on the play. Focasado, excuse me. 8:46 left. Mac driving. They look to, I think, pound the final nail into it and finish off this win here in week 3 of the OUA schedule. Clock running with 8:35 left. And a 2nd-and-3 coming up. Quinlan in the shotgun. as he is on almost every play. Pressure coming off the right side, goes deep down the right sideline and misses his man, but a flag flies, and that could be pass interference on the GGs, and if it is, it's an automatic first down. Mac had one-on-one coverage to the outside. Max Cameron flying down the right sideline, and he was held up by Randy Williams on that play. And Williams would be the second time, I believe, today that Williams has been flagged for pass interference. First one was in the end zone and led to a McMaster touchdown. This one will move the Marauders deeper into scoring range. It could be a legal contact on a receiver. I didn't see the signal. But yeah, it is. Indeed, it is. So a 10-yard foul instead of 15. Quinlan, quick hitter underneath. Actually, Marshall Ferguson's come in at quarterback now for the Marauders, so it's probably the last that we'll see of Kyle Quinlan today. Marshall Ferguson played not too far, his high school ball not too far from here at Frontenac down in Kingston. Again, guy who would start at a lot of schools in the OUA, is the sort of the heir apparent to Kyle Quinlan. Next year it'll probably be all his. Third year man. So second and six for the Marauders after the short completion by Ferguson. See, they played conservative here. There's the play action. That's the completion. First down. And the Marauders are looking to add another touchdown. Nice catch on the play by Tyler Lovedaith, second-year receiver from Forest Heights in Kitchener, which has sort of been a little bit of a recruiting hotbed for the Marauders. Going right into Laurier's backyard. It's not surprising it would be, because that's Stefan Potasek's old high school, I believe. First Potasek played, as Miles Garrell was saying at halftime, played at Laurier and was offensive coordinator at Laurier before he came to Hamilton in 2006 to be the head coach of the Marauders. He's one of the few people, I believe, who's got Vanier Cup rings as a player, as a coordinator, and as a head coach. So first and goal for the eight from the Marauders. They've got their second string backfield in the game. Ferguson, pressure coming, and he's sacked. The GG defense was playing this out to the end. Andrew Randall got in there along with Trevor Seal and backed the Marauders up with 6:45 to go. It's going to be credited to Seal. He was the first man in there. Randall just came in there to get an extra piece of Ferguson, as no defensive linemen are wont to do. Got to make sure. So second and goal back at the 15 now. Trevor Seals played had himself a couple sacks today. The GG defenses, they've gotten in there. I mean, Quinlan wasn't sacked in the first two games, but I believe that's the fourth sack overall by the GG defense today. They're going to run the draw to Moore. Moore looking for daylight, makes a nice cut, and pushes the pile down inside the five, but they needed to get to the end zone on that play. So it looks like they're just setting up Carpina for a chip shot field goal. Not a bad call by Mac. You know, just play it safe. Let the chips fall where they may on that play. If Moore somehow had made all 15 yards, you know, more power to him. But ultimately, they'll run Carpina to try the short field goal, as we're now down to fewer than 6 minutes to play. Of course, next week we'll be back here at Beckwith. GG's against the Laurier Golden Hawks. Laurier beat the G's last season. Carpina indeed does add the field goal, his second of the day. Just an 11-yarder. 5:26 left now. Score now 43-16 for McMaster. So nice homecoming for Tyler Carpina. Two for two on field goals. Some nice deep kickoffs. Pinned the GG's inside their 20 at several times, although you did have one shanked punt that I'm sure he's knowing how athletes are and how they always, you know, will focus on the one mistake more than the, you know, nine things they did right. He'll probably obsess over that a little bit over the next week. But certainly a special, very special place kicker. So the GGs will start from the 35, clock running with 5:20 left. Mac, you know, we're going to see a lot of substituting by both teams, I think, here down the stretch, especially McMaster, as they get their starters out early. There's a bit of another inside handoff, but quickly the Marauders all over Brendan, over Frank Nagundi. Nick Shorthill made the stop, and Shorthill's had a nice game. Think of a couple times he came flying up to trip up the GG ball carrier behind the line of scrimmage. That time it's a gain of two. GGs, of course, they've actually have been huddling a bit more here in the second half. Maybe not surprising. Gillander's straight drop, going deep for Lamar Kahn. Diving catch attempt, but can't come up with it. Would have been a highlight reel grab by Simone Lamar Kahn, but it just needed those cuticles to be a little bit longer as he can't quite bring it in. So a quick two and out again, and Falvo's back in at the kick with 4:31 left. And again, still down on Kingston, still 11-10 for Western after Dylan Walmsley, Queen's rookie kicker, missed from 46 yards. That was after Queens had taken over at the Mustang 39, but couldn't move on back-to-back plays. They haven't been able to run well. And anyone who watched the University of Rush game might not be surprised with that. Ryan Granberg only had 55 yards. Falvo with a good kick despite the win. Negaleka is quickly tackled by Lamar Kong, who probably wants to take out some frustration after that dropped pass moments ago. So Mack will start from the 31. As we're now down to 4:02 remaining in the ball game. I've actually seen a bit of one guy we haven't seen a lot yet from McMaster is Dallin Brooks, or the second-year slot back. Mack typically lines up with five receivers on every play. Andrew Masadi is going to get some run here at slot back. As Mack's starting to work in some of their substitutes. And Stefan Potasek, one thing, he likes to get all eight offensive linemen dressed for the game. Lots of playing time. Because eventually, those guys are going to have to play. I mean, when people graduate, when people go down with injuries. Ferguson, of course, is in at quarterback now. He came up big for the Marauders last year. Of course, Kyle Quinlan was suspended after being arrested for his part in a fight at a campus pub and missed three games. Ter Seal, of course, meantime is limping out, but Ferguson came in and started three games, those three games later. McMaster won all of them, kept the momentum going, and then went on to win the Vanier Cup, and the rest, as they say, is history. Of course, Ferguson also took over some of the punting duties last year. It was especially effective running fake punts because he's the quarterback. He's got more behind him in the backfield. Seal limped down on the last play. Quick hitter to Masadi, his first catch of the afternoon, and a first down before he's pushed out of bounds. Tunchikaya, the rookie defensive back who played for the Myers Riders, herded him into touch. 3:40 to go. Akaya and Dustin Wilson, we've seen a lot of in the second half. Gigi's about to fall to 0-3. And like I say, they'll be in a must-win situation next week against Laurier. There's a bit of an inside handoff to Moore as a flag flies. He cuts it up inside. Goes for about seven, but this play might not stand. Signal is a hold against McMaster.
Holding on McMaster.
By the way, a shout out to a Streaming Sports Network Canada alumnus. Mark Norris, we all know we take a lot of pride and joy in the fact that our own Mark Masters is now a reporter at TSN. It wasn't so long that Mark was calling basketball for us. I'm doing a 10K in a couple of weeks, and Mark actually just made a donation to me. So, Mark, if you're out there, thanks, buddy, and keep up the great work. Next play will bring in the three-minute warning as it's 1st and 20 for the Marauders. Ferguson looks left, throws the quick hitter, and has a nice completion for a gain of about 13 on the play. Joshua Vanderweer gets his first catch of the afternoon, who's Matt works in the second string receivers. Their reward for the hard week of practice really impressed, of course, by the McMaster turnout. But, I mean, then again, they should have a good turnout on the road. They won the national championship last year. But definitely a lot of Mac fans. They were out 2 hours before kickoff. No tailgating, though. This is Ontario, after all. Second and six officially for the Marauders. Ferguson, deep drop. Dopp drops it off, but this time Van de Weert has to reach back for the catch and can't come up with it. And if he had held onto the ball, he was going to get plowed by Daly. So the GG defense gets the stop. And we'll get the ball back with 2:32, possibly for the last time this afternoon. They've only been able to breach the Marauder end zone once this afternoon, and that was Colvin did that on his own with an improvised 25-yard scramble. Rapinoe is going to try the punt directionally. Vince Campbell down, taking it at about his 21. Oh, obvious block in the back. And he's quickly wrestled down. Chris Daly absolutely just hammered Mike Daly from behind. That's going to back the GDs up, likely probably to around their 10-yard line. We're mentioning Sam Sabrin, South Carleton High School alumnus, just had a sack in that Queens Western game. Unfortunately, you don't get any points for those if you're looking at it from a Queens perspective and Western's still clinging to an 11-10 lead in that rivalry game. They're always been close between those two schools. Not whenever it's on the line, everyone thinks of that Yates Cup in 2009. 43-39 for Queens, 7 lead changes in that game. Then, of course, they had a 27-26 game in the regular season that was decided in the final 20 seconds. Looks like a bit of a mishandled snap, and the ball is loose and covered. We've also got an injured Gigi on the field as they're just trying to get through this game without further incident. It's actually Frank Nagundi who's down, and they could ill afford to lose him. He's one of their most dynamic talents on offense, but again, bad snap was mishandled by Colvin. This is sort of the area of the game where you know, concentration become an issue. I mean, the score is what it is, 43-16 for McMaster with 2 minutes 15 seconds left. You know, you're just trying to get through the last bit of it, maybe have some good things to take into the next week of practice and the next game, but concentration can waver. Colvin dropped the snap and in the scramble for the ball. One of their running backs gets hurt. Those things, you know, just one of those things that can happen. Not playing a blame game or anything. Looks like Frank's up and doing, coming up slowly, and limping off, jogging off under his own power. So it doesn't look like it's a serious injury. But it might probably be for the best if he just rested the rest of this game. Expose himself to aggravating it any further. So second and 15 back at the 4 after the 5-yard loss. Marauders look like they're going to bring a bit of heat here. Colvin fading to pass, throws the quick one over the middle, but misses Simon Lamarcant, and that's incomplete. Now it's going to be third and 15. So Gigi's will bring up the punt team, and I'd assume they might concede a safety here, just to decrease the chance of Max scoring another touchdown. It's mostly academic with exactly 2 minutes to play in the game. But that's just, you know, standard operating procedure in these circumstances. You know, the story of this game obviously was back in the first quarter. Mac had an early turnover. The GGs weren't able to capitalize. Then Mac went down, 3 straight touchdowns, all drives over 70 yards, built a 23-0 lead. GGs twice got back within 10, and they do indeed concede the safety, so it's now 45-16. But then Kyle Quinlan broke it wide open again. Long touchdown strike to Max Cameron down the left sideline. Sort of had the free play after the GGs were offside. Then right after that, went back to work and ran one in himself. So Kyle Quinlan obviously will be our unofficial GG's football on SSN Canada player of the game. Passed for 3 touchdowns and with no interceptions, rushed for the other 2 McMaster scores. Defensively, Steven Ventresca took down 2 interceptions, first 2 of the season thrown by Aaron Colvin. On the GG side of things, definitely go with Frank Marvell Nagundi as offensive player of the game, more than 100 yards from scrimmage when you tally up all his rushes and receptions. Defensively, really like the job that Trevor Griffiths did. There's the handoff to Moore inside. Moore with a nice head of steam has the first down all the way out to the 48 of the Marauders. Gain of 13 for this, you know, bowling ball runner. And again, Mac, you know, so deep at tailback. Moore from a rookie from Richview Collegiate in Etobicoke. And if that name rings a bell, that's of course the alma mater of one of the highest paid Canadian athletes in the world, Cincinnati Reds first baseman Joey Votto. But Richview is an athletic powerhouse, and you know, obviously football and basketball as well. Mac still in the hurry up. We're down to 90 seconds in the game. There's another quick handoff to Moore. This time the GGs get good pursuit, but Moore just bobs and weaves and has another first down. Chris Daly gets a nice lick in on one of the Marauder linemen by pancaking him away from the play. Frustration this afternoon for the GG defense as Moore gets back-to-back first downs. 1:16 left. But overall, not a bad football experience down here. The GG still have three more home games left in the season. Chance to treat, you know, great support from the local community. This time the GG sniff out the run, and Moore is going to be stuffed up for a huge loss. Pierre-Yves Laverne with a big tackle. Gain loss of about 5 on the play. That's the thing with McMaster sort of, you know, they like to change it up, sort of run the sort of the, almost like a change of pace in the backfield. A lot of misdirection, a lot of quick plays where the running back takes one steps in one direction, then cuts back the other way. But if someone shoots the gap, it's going to be a big, big loss. See if Ferguson goes to the air or if it's just a handoff here on 2nd and 14. As we're down to less than a minute to play, and it's that quick shovel pass to Masadi. Masadi gets close to a first down, drags tacklers, and may actually have it. Andrew Masadi, out of Cardinal Newman in Stony Creek, just south of Hamilton. Has some impressive punt returns and receptions here, and that first down will give the Marauders a chance to kneel out the clock here. Clock running now, 24 seconds. We're probably going to wrap this up quickly right after the final gun. Marauders just have to kneel down twice or run two plays at least just to end it. And they'll go to 3-0. The GGs will fall to 0-3 pending with a must-win game next week against the Laurier Golden Hawks. Big round of applause for the Marauders. And that is it. They kneel it out. That's the game. 45-16, the final score for the McMaster Marauders over the Ottawa GGs. Cal Quinlan accounts for 5 touchdowns. Aaron Colbin accounts for the only GGs TD. For our producer, Matt Copeland, for our camera operator, Jill Sally, I'm Nate Sager. Hope you enjoyed the game. We'll be back next week, 1 o'clock on Streaming Sports Network Canada, sscancanada.ca, with another edition of GG's Football. Thanks for joining us this afternoon. Hope it was a good one.